push to any law. Doon sa laban ng masa before. And so we're part of the social movements, groups supporting the right to self-determination, not only of the Bangsamoro people, but the, you know, include Cordillera people too, and the rights of the indigenous people. Kaya po, full support kami doon sa implementation ng BOL, Bangsamoro Organic Law, and doon sa mga ginagawa ng Bangsamoro Transition Authority, and we really want to make sure na they're well-funded, na magawa nila yung trabaho nila para po talagang matulungan natin yung mamamayan, yung Bangsamoro. And gusto naming matiyak ngayong election nila doon sa parliament will take place itong June 2022, an election that we want to be really ensure to be fair and free of violence, and ensuring the genuine autonomy of the BARM government, Bangsamoro, and the fully functioning unit of government, and ensuring too, while saying that, kasi we work closely with the Bangsamoro people on the ground, yung not the political dynasties.
Okay, maraming salamat po, Mr. Sonny Milencio. We will now hear from Senator Coco Pimentel. Go ahead, sir.
Mayong buntag sa tanan. Maraming salamat mo po for inviting me to attend this webinar on behalf of my presidential candidate, Senator Manny Pacquiao. Alam niyo po mga kababayan, ang ating organic law for the BARM is a peace document contained in a law of a political nature. So ang ibig sabihin noon, kasama na po ang history diyan, kasama na po ang taong bayan diyan, kasama rin po ang mga lawmakers diyan. So buong lipunan, buong bansa ay invested po rito sa BARM. And then ito ay bagong batas, approved only in January 2019. Kung tutuusin, nasa transition period pa ito. Hence, ang posisyon po namin ni presidential candidate Manny Pacquiao, we have to give this very important, critical, and crucial document a chance to prove its worth, to give the benefits to the people. And hindi ko na po kailangan sabihin na si Senator Manny Pacquiao ay galing po dyan sa lugar ng Mindanao, born in Sarangani, born in Bukidnon, actually, laki sa hirap, marunong kumayod. Nakita rin niya ang epekto ng lack of peace and kakulangan ng hustisya, lalo na sa mga mahihirap. Kaya bibigyan po natin ito ng pagkakataon na makita natin ang kagalingan at kabutihan na idudulot ng BARM law sa area po ng BARM. Maraming okay. Salamat.
Maraming salamat po, Senator Coco Pimentel. At ngayon naman po, tatawagin po natin si former Secretary Emmanuel Piñol.
Thank you, Christian. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi taala wabarakatuh. Magandang umaga po sa inyo lahat. First, I'd like to congratulate and thank the organizers of this Bangsamoro Agenda 2022 Forum. This is a very important forum that everybody must be involved with. I'm a farmer. I was born in Cotabato. Born and raised during the period of conflict. Kaya naiintindihan ko tong issue na ito. Much to my disappointment, however, while everybody's talking about the Ukraine war, everybody's talking about COVID-19, not much attention is given to peace in Mindanao, the Bangsamoro issue. Let me emphasize this. Mindanao contributes 45% of the total food requirements of the country. In fact, ang Bangsamoro area alone is the biggest producer of aqua and fisheries products all over the country. Napakalaking potensyal. Subalit, kapag hindi natin nahawakan itong gains of peace, achieved by the Duterte administration, we may get lost once again. Kaya ang aming posisyon sa aming partido, Reforma at saka Nationalist People's Coalition, na pinangungunahan ng aming presidential candidate, Panfilo Ping Lacson, is to fully support the peace agreement, the Bangsamoro program for Mindanao, sapagkat ako'y naniniwala na ang Mindanao will be critical in our dream of achieving food sufficiency in this country, in producing enough energy for this country, and most of all, in making this country progressive. Sa ngalan po ng aking partido at ng aking presidential candidate, Panfilo Ping Lacson, let me once again congratulate the organizers of this forum. You are contributing greatly to the peace and prosperity of this nation. Thank you.
Hey, Manny Piñol. So maraming salamat po sa ating mga panelists, our guests, for their opening statements. So sa ngayon po, sisimulan na po natin ang iba't ibang mga tanong para sa ating mga bisita para sa araw na ito. Our first question is, the Bangsamoro Organic Law, which is based on the 2014 Comprehensive Agreement on the Bangsamoro, provided greater power and autonomy to the new Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao, or BARM. Now, under this power-sharing arrangement between the national and the regional government, how involved will your presidential candidate's administration be in the affairs of the BARM in the next 6 years? So, ang sagot po nyo, you will be given, each of you will be given 1 minute to respond to this question. Ang una po magtatanong ay si former Congressman Teddy Bagilat. Go ahead, sir. Kindly unmute yourself, Congressman Bagilat. Ayan.
Sorry. Okay. Very important talaga yung involvement ng presidente to ensure that the implementation of the Bangsamoro law is very successful. Kaya napakahalaga talaga yung pagpapalakas din ng intergovernment relations services ng ating systems, ng ating pamahalaan, which is incorporated into the law. Vice President Lenny Robredo has made it her priority to ensure na pag siya ang maging presidente ay maganda ang coordination from the national, regional hanggang sa local levels, no? The national counterparts together with their regional counterparts pagdating doon sa transition period, pagdating doon sa transfer of responsibilities, mga facilities, no, resources, at the same time yung mga mandates, no, from the national agencies to the BARM government, importante yon. So we will also try to study the possibility of creating a cabinet position that will oversee yung Bangsamoro development, no? So it's a cabinet position for Bangsamoro.
Former Congressman Teddy Bagilat. The next to respond to that question, the same question, is Ms. Samira Gutok. You have 1 minute.
Assalamualaikum. Self-governance, as articulated doon sa Bangsamoro activity namin sa Maguindanao recently, sa Bulacan, ay sinabi pong push goal. So the least intervention, no, by a president who is only supportive of an autonomy, no, as mentioned cited in our constitution, or the at arm. Doon, syempre, moral governance na filosofiya, kung ano ang kinakailangang suporta, mentoring, o kaya assistance kung anuman sa intergovernmental board na yan ay ibibigay po ng national. Inarticulate din yon sa meeting natin dito sa may mga Muslim sectors and other concerned stakeholders kahapon, ay kilalanin po kung meron pang kailangan yung Bangsamoro outside Bangsamoro, who live outside Luzon, who live outside Bangsamoro, ay sana po bigyan nga ng kalinga dahil wala pong pondo yan po. Chris, ngayon, wala pong pera ang Bangsamoro outside Bangsamoro. Walang opisina po sila. At alam niyo ba, Sir Chris, everyone, mas marami po ang Bangsamoro outside Bangsamoro. We're talking 7 million Muslim Filipinos outside of our 4 million.
Okay. Maraming salamat po, Ms. Samira Gutok. Next to respond is Mr. Sonny Melencio. Go ahead, sir. You have 1 minute.
Yes. I think Si Caliotti will be hands-on. dito sa Bangsamoro program nito, platform. Actually, naglilibot siya sa Mindanao ngayon and he's been consulting with various groups sa Mindanao, including mga Bangsamoro organizations doon, including the network that we have established in the past in support of the right to self-determination of the Bangsamoro people. So magpapatuloy yan. And I think what he will do sa pagka kung siya ang maupo, magpapatawag ng malaking consultation which will involve the Bangsamoro Transition Authority at yung mga Bangsamoro group, support groups, and all the movements, social movements na nagde-develop sa Mindanao, the tribe people a network to talk about what is the agenda that they would like to pursue. Kasi in keeping with the right to self-determination framework, we would like to consult the people in the Bangsamoro areas first.
Thank okay. you. Maraming salamat po, Mr. Sonny Melencio. Let's now call on Senator Coco Pimentel.
The question is how involved President Manny Pacquiao will be in BARM. So he will be very much involved. Una sa lahat, he is from Mindanao. Number two, he believes in the right to self-determination. He believes actually in local autonomy, then federalism. And then meron din sa batas the president shall exercise general supervision over the Bangsamoro government to ensure that laws are faithfully executed. So we will have to live up to that duty. Ang advantage si Senator Manny Pacquiao, bata, energetic, physically fit na tao, and he wants to solve actual problems. So talagang tututukan po niya ang Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao. At saka, as I stated earlier, alam natin na nasa transition pa ito, definitely may birth pains ito. So the president must keep his eyes on the barn. Tutukan natin ang mga problema sa implementation ng bagong batas.
Okay, thank you very much, Senator Coco Pimentel. Let's now hear from Secretary Manny Piñol.
Ko lang pong ipaalam na dalawang pananaw ang ibabahagi ko sa forum na ito. Yung pananaw ng aming partido, aming standard bearer, Ping Lacson, and my personal views on this issue, given the fact that I was the point person of the president for the Bangsamoro when I was Minda Secretary. Officially, like any other local government unit, the president's authority over the management of the BARM affairs is merely that of general supervision and not control. Yan po yung posisyon ng aming partido. This is also expressly stated in the BOL. The chief executive has the authority over them, but this will only be limited to overseeing that the authority granted to them under the Bangsamoro Organic Law is implemented according to the mandate of their Organic Act. Personally, having been involved directly with the BARM as the point person of the president, I will engage officials of the Bangsamoro officially and personally.
Okay, maraming salamat po, Secretary Manny Piñol. So pupunta naman po tayo sa ating pangalawang katanungan para sa ating mga panauhin sa araw na ito. So Republic Act 11593, the law that extended the BTA until 2025, states that the president may appoint the 80 new interim members of the Bangsamoro Transition Authority. Now we know that President Duterte opted not to exercise this. But will your candidate, if elected, appoint a new set of BTA officials who will serve until June 30, 2025? Okay? So, mamaya na po natin susundin yung ano yung rotating order, no? So, sa punto pong ito, sundin po muna natin order na to. So, una pong sasagot si Congressman Teddy Bagilat. You have the floor, sir.
Hey, discussions are always welcome when it comes to extending yung terms ng BTA natin. No? But siguro mas mahalaga for Lenny Robredo yung ayusin natin yung roadmap, no? From now until 2025. Meron talagang mga milestones yung BTA para siguraduhin lang na kung maaari, no, by 2025 ay mag-transition na tayo dun sa Bangsamoro Parliament. No? So definitely magkakaroon ng mga usapan, no, with the Bangsamoro government to establish these milestones importante rin siguro magkaroon tayo ng develop yung criteria on how to choose the BTA representatives, no? Magkaroon talaga ng malawakang consultation with stakeholders just to ensure na while right now the BTA is of course going to be MILF led, pero maganda rin na yung mga ibang stakeholders sa Bangsamoro, the IPs, no, at mga iba pang mga katauhan doon ay magbigyan rin ng representasyon dito sa BTA. Maraming salamat po.
Maraming salamat po, Congressman Teddy Bagilat. Let's now call on Ms. Samira Gutok.
This is a presidential prerogative, no, to do a new set of officers. Well, a discussion, I agree, echoes. Pero dun sa discussion po ni Isko Moreno, Action, and si Chief Murad, there was a commitment for continuity. And of course, this will be subject to some operational discussions po. Pagkilala po sa kinakailangan, sinabi niya rin sa akin kahapon, yung merit-based, yung pag-accomplish, yung ating pag-audit o kaya pag-assessment, no, sa ating pangyayaring transition. Kasi importante po, tingnan yung normalisasyon, yung pag-push ng mga combatants towards normalcy, yung ating budgetary needs, no, kung lahat ng admin codes ay naisulat na rin po. So yun po ang isang proseso na gagawin para makita na yung MILF pa at saka new blood ay dadagdagan. Ang commitment po natin is merit-based, qualification-based, at sana po makita na yung MILF is still organic to such process po.
Samira Gutok. Let's now hear from Mr. Sonny Melencio.
With the upholding the self-determination. So sa bagay na yan, kasi alam ko this is a very sensitive issue. Especially kung ang appointment ay manggagaling dun sa Imperial Manila. So we have to consult Bangsamoro groups itself, and let's have a wider consultation with the yung mga bumubuo na nitong Transition Authority, the Bangsamoro groups, the Tri People groups, and others. And then I will just go back to, kasi ina-extend na natin ang ina-extend, I think we should also have to look into the yung deliverables, what's happening with that, kasi we have to deliver yung mga pinangako dito sa Bangsamoro Organic Law, and it's important that we start with that, and then we start with let's continue with the consultation, let's involve more people. If we need to expand the numbers of the Bangsamoro Parliament, let's do that.
Okay. Thank you. Maraming salamat po, Mr. Sonny Melencio. Next, we'll have Senator Coco Pimentel.
The default position of Team Pacquiao is that we will allow the current crop of BTA members to finish the job given to them. Let's give them a chance to prove their worth and then to make use of their knowledge and skills. But, of course, if there is a compelling reason from consultation with the leaders on the ground that there is a need to change membership, we will do it. Pero ang default namin, if there's no compelling reason, finish your job. Kasi we know that we are still in a transition period. Marami kayong dapat gawin. Kulang pa yung codes na dapat ma-enact po nila. So yun po yung aming attitude, no? So let's give these people a chance to prove that they are well deserving of the appointments given to them.
Senator Coco Pimentel, we'll now hear from Secretary Manny Piñol.
Walang pong maintindihan ng ating mga participants at saka nakikinig na yung aking principal, yung aming presidential candidate, si Ping Lacson, had a long career in law enforcement. Kaya yung mindset niya is palaging majesty of the law. So to the question, will he appoint? As mandated under the law, the president is duty bound to implement it and appoint a new set of BTA officials as he has a sworn obligation to faithfully execute the laws of the land. However, he assures everybody that the appointments will be based on merit and fitness with the end goal of ultimately promoting the interests of the Bangsamoro people. Thank you.
Secretary Manny Piñol, Let's now move on to our next question for our guests. The question is, actually, pinadala po ito ng isa sa mga stakeholders at nanonood sa atin po ngayon. How would your administration cooperate with the Bangsamoro Parliament to implement national development objectives, for example, in the areas of education and public health? So, sa round na po ito, so medyo iibahin natin ng konti ano, no? Yung order. Pero magsisimula po tayo muli kay Samira Gutok. Go ahead.
Thank you. Assalamu alaikum. Enhance a productive collaboration. Siyempre po, minsan kailangan ng donor linkaging, kailangan po ng grants support, kailangan po ng pagbigay ng enabling, no? Environment para po matulungan ang poorest of the poor. Alam natin po, infant mortality, maternal mortality, highest po sa amin. Hindi pa rin namin po natitaste yung gains ng ating natural resource from Tawi-Tawi to Marawi where I am from. And syempre, Marawi rehabilitation na hinihingan talaga natin ng pagbilis ng pag-fast track. So with all the MDGs, MBS, minimum basic needs of water, sanitation, and health, the national government can provide the mentoring support from the national agency if there needs technical support, if there needs technical assistance, if there needs to be subsidy again to add to the block grant or technical, ay nandito po ang national government. Nakita po yan sa national or Muslim cemetery nakita sa Manila, pwede pong i-replicate sa atin.
Mayra Gutok, let's now call on Mr. Sonny Melencio.
We have to really, the national government should really assist in making sure that the Bangsamoro Organic Law is implemented and implemented fully. Kaya we have to work with the parliament at yung role ng national government has to be also be very active in promoting the development of the Bangsamoro areas. Kaya we have to allocate more budgets doon sa, lalo na dito sa rehabilitation of Marawi City na nabanggit na hindi pa rin nakukumpleto. At yung mga budget na ilalaan yan dapat in addition doon sa kung ano yung budget na ipinasa natin for the Bangsamoro Transition Authority. Heavily hit ng COVID-19 itong Bangsamoro areas. So we have to do something na ayusin yung health situation nila. So cooperation with the national government and the Bangsamoro Parliament on how the health setup should be implemented. And it should cover all the areas of the Bangsamoro and the tribe area. Thank you.
Maraming salamat po, Mr. Sonny Melencio. Next, we'll have Senator Coco Pimentel.
Ang napili pong paraan for the national government and the regional government coordinate at ito ay nasa batas ay yung tinatawag na intergovernmental relations bodies. Marami po yan. So let us give this a chance, itong mekanismo na napili po sa batas. So buhayin lahat yan, yung intergovernmental relations bodies na yan, from public finance to infrastructure, to parliamentary forum, lahat po yan, buhayin, buuhin at saka buhayin. Tapos there is also this concept that the national government can continue to help the regional government through national projects which will be funded by the national government. So since this is an autonomous region and conscious sila or sensitive sila sa right to self-determination, we can continue helping the autonomous region through the chosen mechanism of these intergovernmental relations bodies. So yan po ang technique na gagamitin po natin.
Okay, maraming salamat po, Senator Coco Pimentel. Next, we'll have Secretary Manny Piñol.
Ang Minda Chairman, although I was tasked to be the point person for the BARM, medyo nag-iingat kami sa pakikialam sa mga programa ng BARM because there are existing mechanisms. And one of these is the intergovernmental relations body, which is already provided by the law under the Bangsamoro Organic Law. And it is tasked to coordinate, resolve issues on intergovernmental relations, and it is done through regular consultations and continuing negotiations. The president, our president, will maximize this mechanism to ensure the attainment of national development objectives. But then again, may advantage kami. Kasi malalim yung pangunawa ko sa operation ng BARM as the point person of the president before I resign. Thank you.
salamat po, Secretary Manny Piñol. And finally, we'll have former Congressman Teddy Bagila to respond to that question.
Okay, thank you. Well, kinakailangan talaga fully developed and functional yung ating intergovernmental relations, yung mga mechanisms under the IGRS. And while education and health are within the domain of the Bangsamoro government, pero ang support ng national nasa technical and funding support. Kaya importante rin talaga na agarang ma-release yung mga block grants no, to the Bangsamoro government. At sumasang-ayon ako na talagang kinakailangan rin na tumulong ang national government. No? At yan ang plano ni Vice President Lenny Robredo kasi yan naman yung talino niya, yung makapag-access ng international and local donor agencies na matulungan yung Bangsamoro. As well as connecting the Bangsamoro government to economic gateways with the neighboring countries. No? Importante rin yun. We should be able to assist the BARM government in linking with local and international development agencies as well as developing economic agreements no, with neighboring countries. So yun po yung panukala ni Vice President Lenny Robredo.
Okay, thank you Congressman Teddy Bagilat. Now dito po sa susunod na tanong, ang una pong sasagot si Mr. Sunny Melencio. Ang tanong po, would your administration consider amending the BOL to reduce o bawasan yung block grant in order to mitigate the national fiscal deficit? Go ahead, Mr. Sunny Melencio.
I think it's better na increase kaysa bawasan. Kasi nabanggit nga natin, we're starting the situation na maraming dapat i-repair, maraming dapat i-reconstruct sa Mindanao. And it's all so due doon sa mga matagal nang napabayaan yan at yung sa Marawi. And other problems that still continue. So I would I think ang aming idea ay talagang instead of papalitin pa yan, damihan pa yan, it could not be part of the block grant, but it could be part of other funding na dapat ibigay ng national government to ensure that will be development, full scale development in Mindanao, especially in terms of agriculture, as was mentioned na malaki yung ating inaasahan dyan to provide for our food security.
Maraming salamat po, Mr. Sunny Melencio. Next to respond is Senator Coco Pimentel.
Huwag natin bawasan yung block grant kasi una sa lahat may reason bakit pinigay yan. That is affirmative action and that is an amount determined through deliberations na makakatulong sa lugar. Especially if they now the parliament decides or the government, the regional government decides the priorities for the regional government. Anyway, nandun din sa batas no, that the formula for the block grant will be reviewed after a certain period of time. And then dahan-dahan din binabawas po yung base kung saan po kinukuha yung 5%. For the block grant. So ano na po 'yan, built in na po 'yun yung pagdahan-dahan pagbaba ng amount ng block grant because ang assumption ng batas dahan-dahan naman paakyat o maasenso na po ang BARNM. So that's already anticipated. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you Senator Coco Pimentel. Next we'll have Secretary Manny Piñol.
Effective governance kasi hindi nakasalalay kung gaano kalaki yung pera mo o budget mo. It actually depends on how you utilize your budget. So ang question, dadagdagan, babawasan? It all depends on how the block grant has been utilized by the BARM. There should be an accounting on how these block grants granted by the national government and received by the BARM had been utilized. At kung ito ba'y nakatulong sa pag-implementa ng mga programa. So I've said, we're not saying na babawasan. We're not also saying na dadagdagan. Depende yan sa utilization ng budget. Kasi uulitin ko, maski gaano kalaki ang budget, kung hindi nagagamit ng tama, wala ring epekto yun sa ating governance.
Then we'll have former Congressman Teddy Bagilat. Go ahead, sir.
Fiscal autonomy kasi is very important for the success of the Bangsamoro government. And yung block grants is very integral to it. No? So ang position ni Lenny Obredo is not to amend the law in order to reduce the block grants, no. Pero ang mas gusto naming tutukan actually is the efficient and effective use of the block grants, no, para siguraduhin na yung pondo ay magagamit talaga for the development and for the benefit, no, of the people of Bangsamoro. Because eventually naman magkakaroon ng discussions sometime in the future whether the block grants need to be increased or whether it can be reduced, no. Hopefully when we talk about reduction of block grants, ibig sabihin talaga gumaganda na rin, no, ang sitwasyon ng ang development ng Bangsamoro region. But for the meantime, no, block grants are really very essential, and therefore walang plano po ang Robredo administration na palitan yung batas tungkol sa block grants. Maraming salamat po.
Congressman Teddy Bagilat. Next, we'll have Ms. Samira Gutok.
Yes, pagkilala po na maliit. Totoo naman po, maliit pa yung taxation contribution namin, mga remittances. Can you imagine po, Mindanao State University, former regent ako, sir. Napaka, almost zero companies po kami sa Lanao, which is the second largest population ng Bangsamoro. At maliit nga rin po talaga yung naiaambag namin sa nasyonal. Pero po, pag isang bomba, kagaya ng Marawi, nangyari nga sa amin o kaya sa Sulu, ay mangyari. Lakas din naman ng pagbaba ng ekonomiya ng ibang parte natin sa Mindanao at therefore sa Pilipinas. So napakalaki po that the pain of one is the pain of the whole country, and therefore decreasing it would be detrimental. I would push for increase even. Alam natin, mas malaki ang pera natin ay sweldo, hindi infra na kinakailangan, hospital, katubigan, sanitasyon, para sa mga malnourished at all. So kinakailangan po talaga, steady po yan, o kung pwede pa dagdagan.
Salamat po, Ms. Samira Gutok. We'll now move on with our questions. Dito po sa next question, ang una pong sasagot ay si Senator Coco Pimentel. Okay? The question is, how would your administration deal with violent extremists that are based in the barm? Go ahead, sir.
Yes, the Pacquiao administration, in addition to the expected police action, no, to maintain law and order in the region, we'll have to make sure that the commitments in the peace documents, no longer in the law ito, sa labas na po to, the other documents which were made basis of the law, like the disarming, the decommission, there's an independent decommissioning body to make sure that the armed combatants are assisted into a civilian, a peaceful civilian way of life. So ituloy po natin yun para yung mindset po ay magbago na. And the Pacquiao administration will also take advantage of this new treaty that the Philippines just entered into, the Arms Trade Treaty. Ito po ay makakatulong sa atin to help the flow, minimize the trade in illicit firearms.
Okay, maraming salamat po, Senator Coco Pimentel. Next, Secretary Manny Piñol. Go ahead, sir.
Any action that falls under the acts prohibited by the Anti-Terrorism Act of 2020 shall be dealt with in accordance with the law. That is the official position of my party. But then again, our party supports the recommendation of International Alert Philippines that there should be a better orchestrated approach in preventing violent extremism with a combination of capacity building in the de-radicalization of the youth, implementation of restorative justice programs, more social media campaigns to prevent recruitment into extremist groups, and intensified intelligence gathering and security operations. Thank you.
Manny Piñol. Next, we'll have Congressman Teddy Bagilat.
Approach po ang solusyon ni Vice President Lenny Robredo. So aside from the military action against extremism, importante rin kasing malaman natin ano ba ang ugat ng extremism. No? It could be religious intolerance or religious fanaticism. Kasama na rin siyempre dyan yung desperation. So what are the vulnerable sectors? Mga kabataan, mga feeling nila na aape. No? Kasi kung may kahirapan, they galit sila sa gobyerno, madali silang ma-convert into fanaticism. So importante talaga na magkaroon tayo ng mga socio-economic programs doon sa mga vulnerable sectors, especially the youth, no? And maybe as a specific piece of legislation, we are pushing, no, si Robredo and our tropa is pushing for the passage of the TJR or Transitional Justice and Reconciliation Law, no? Just to address, no, yung mga social injustices or historical injustices of the past. So TJR law is also one very important aspect of our program to deal with extremism. Maraming okay. Salamat po.
Salamat po, Congressman Teddy Bagilat. Next, we'll have Ms. Samira Gutok.
Ang professionalization at entry ng ating MILF forces into the national AFP, if not the PNP. Kailangan po may mga kababaihan na mismo peacemakers on the ground. Alam niyo po, humarap po ako mismo dyan sa Violent Extremism Partnership with the Philippine Army 103rd. Napakalaking pondo ang kailangan nila po for trust building, confidence building, engaging. Wala pong pondo po masyado ang PNP Civilian Relations Unit and Army Civilian Relations Unit. Kailangan po yan, pondohan ng nasyonal. Kaya po tayo nakikisama. And of course, I echo the 12-point agenda of the BARM currently on moral governance na kailangan i-leverage po yung MILF forces. And syempre po, pagkilala sa mga MNLF po, hindi kayo nawawala po. And to address violent extremism, support the Islamic schools. It po, lagi naman tayo nangaakusa, pero wala naman po tayong regularization or kaya sweldo mismo sa mga Islamic teachers natin. Books, not bullets. Tractors, not tanks. Engage.
Okay. Salamat, Ms. Samira Gutok. And then finally, we'll have Mr. Sonny Melencio. We cannot hear you.
Okay.
Go ahead, sir. Sige.
Okay. I think the violent extremism, because of the peace process that's now involved the MILF and the MNLF, yeah, even before, is now coming from what we call the SPMS area, the stronghold of the Bangsamoro Islamic Freedom Fighters, and from the municipalities, four municipalities in Mindanao. And I think, the approach should be yung comprehensive approach to pull them out doon sa violent extremism na ito. And that would mean complete development plan, specifically for the areas, agricultural development and modernization, education, and youth employment should be a system that should be put in place, health. Yung hindi natin pinababayaan yung area na yun kasi marami tayong far-flung areas, walang ospital, walang eskwelahan, walang mga necessities na kailangan nilang ibigay natin yun and it will help.
Okay, maraming salamat po Mr. Sonny Melencio. Now, let's move on to our next question. Ito, napaka-importante nito dun sa mga kapatid po natin sa Cordillera. Okay? So the question is, the 1987 Constitution set two autonomous regions in the country. Now, while the BARM has been established, the one in the Cordilleras has remained as an administrative region. The question is, will your president support the autonomy for the Cordilleras? Will he or she support the passage and ratification of the organic law for the Cordillera? So the first to respond is Secretary Manny Piñol.
Yes, our presidential candidate supports the fulfillment of the commitment of our government in the Cordillera region. And we cite Article 10, Section 15 of the Constitution, which states that there should be a regional autonomous government in the Cordillera. In fact, in an interview on December 2021, Senator Ping Lacson said he would let the people of the Cordillera Administrative Region decide on whether it should receive greater autonomy. Or in 2015, he also said that the autonomy in the Cordillera must be pursued for two reasons. Aside from the autonomous region in Muslim Mindanao, it is directly mentioned in the 1987 Constitution. And he believes that the autonomy will funnel more funds to the region from the national government. The only way we can have successful autonomous region is when they are supported. That's the statement of my presidential candidate.
Okay, salamat po, Secretary Manny Piñol. Next, we'll hear from Congressman Teddy Bagilat.
Yeah, thank you very much for that question. No? Really concerns me personally. Yes, President Robredo is very much committed to pushing also for the passage of the Cordillera Autonomous Region. Because yung reasons naman for establishing or creating a Cordillera Autonomous Region are the same with the aspirations, no, of our Muslim brothers and sisters and Lumads in the Bangsamoro region. There's historical injustice, there's underdevelopment, there's the uniqueness of the Cordillera region. Pero when I asked President Lenny, no, dun sa kanyang position tungkol dito, ang sabi niya, dapat manggaling mismo sa mga Cordillerans yung drive to establish a Cordillera Autonomous Region, which I agree because twice it has already failed. So it's about time na dapat magkaroon talaga kami ng self-introspection sa Cordillera. And if we truly believe in the autonomous region, definitely Lenny Robredo will provide the political will to ensure that this region or this law is passed. Thank you very much.
Salamat po, Congressman Teddy Bagilat. Next, we'll have Ms. Samira Gutok. Kindly unmute yourself, ma'am.
Si Isko Moreno was a peace panelist member, so the core of his understanding of autonomy is deeply appreciated by him na kailangan po mutual process na kilalanin. Kaya yung Cordillera talagang alam niya na yung unique culture, ethno-linguistic natin ay intricacy natin ay kilalanin, and therefore the words that he would always support in autonomy, engaged, participative, enlightened, self-determining, dapat po kilalanin yan. Siyempre yung mga tao, always about tao, ay kilalanin yung kanilang self-destiny, yung kanilang pangangailangan. Kaya itong Cordillera is so valuable, organic, especially to me after visiting Kalinga and the areas of Cordillera, napaka-importante sa kanila na dalhin natin sila as part of our Bangsamoro experience na rin ng commitment.
Okay, salamat po, Ms. Samira Gutok. Next, we'll have Mr. Sonny Melencio.
We'll cross party lines dito, ah, kasi I will say si Teddy Bagilat talagang iboto natin sa Senado kasi talagang siya ang nakakaalam nitong sa dito sa kalagayan sa Cordillera. Well, we're also part of it for quite a long time because meron kaming relationship with the Cordillera People's Liberation Army a long time ago, even after the Mount Data Agreement, and then of course the closure agreement na nangyari ng 2011. I think there are still issues. Wala na yung ano na yan, yung CPLA, but there are still issues in terms of integration nila doon sa Philippine Security Forces doon sa area, because it concerns maraming masyadong conditions. Yung mga generals nila, officers nila cannot become generals because they have no education, college education, and then may age limit na. So we have to address that kasi kahapon ganyan din yung sinasabi ng mga MNLF na hindi naayos yung transition. So we have to do that.
Maraming salamat po, Mr. Sonny Melencio. Next, we'll hear from Senator Coco Pimentel. Go ahead, sir.
Si Senator Manny Pacquiao ang official candidate po ng PDP Laban. Ang PDP Laban ay naniniwala sa federalismo, nasa constitution po ng partido yan. At kami ni Senator Manny Pacquiao, alam namin na destination yun. There are some steps that you need to take before you reach your destination. So local autonomy, autonomous regions, and federalism. So definitely supportado po namin itong idea ng Cordillera Autonomous Region. In fact, ako po mismo ay nag-file ng 2 bills in 2012 and 2018. Not perfect bills, but bills still to pursue autonomy in the Cordillera. So I hope that our brothers and sisters in the Cordillera will support future efforts, future bills. If I can refile this bill, let us support this. So yun po yun, all out support po kami In a way, this is a constitutional effort because it is found in the constitution. Dalawa lang po ang autonomous regions na pwede natin kilalanin under the 1987 constitution.
Okay, maraming salamat po, Senator Coco Pimentel. At this point, meron po tayong mga tanong coming from our audience. Ito pong susunod na tanong ay galing po kay former Maguindanao Congressman Attorney Michael Mastura. Si Attorney Mastura po ay dating miyembro ng MILF Peace Panel. His question is, what is your take on the problem of political patronage in the Bangsamoro, the so-called Kamag-anak Incorporated, which is seen in the contracting and outsourcing of project awards? Okay? Ang una pong sasagot si Senator Coco Pimentel. Go ahead, sir.
Una sa lahat, dun muna siguro sa eleksyon, no? Dapat may anti-dynasty provisions ilagay na yung parliament sa kanilang electoral code. Maging stricto na sila diyan. And then yung ating bidding laws nga ang malaking weakness natin, kaya tuloy-tuloy ang corruption sa ating bansa. So kung pwedeng magpakitang gilas ang ating mga kapatid sa BARM, yung kanilang loss dyan on bidding, pagtibayin din nila, not only the words but also in the execution, the implementation. Siguro i-define mabuti yung collusion, yung mga concepts na ganun, kasi sa tingin ko dyan tayo nagkakabutas ngayon.
Senator Coco Pimentel. Next, Secretary Manny Piñol.
Well, sad to say, hindi lang confined sa Bangsamoro actually yung problema na yan. It's a widespread problem involving all agencies of government, all branches of government. No? Ang talagang dapat lang natin gawin dyan, palakasin yung ating mga safety and safeguard mechanisms to prevent collusion in the bidding and yung ating mga batas against nepotism. Dapat mapalakas yan. That's the only way. At I'm sorry to say this, my dear friend, Congressman Mastura, pero hindi nyo monopoly yung ganyang problema. Lahat ng ahensya ng gobyerno, lahat ng LGUs may ganyang problema. Yung monopolya sa mga kontrata, yung pag-a-appoint ng mga kamag-anak. And it should be a national concern, actually. Thank you.
Po, Secretary Manny Piñol. Next, Congressman Teddy Bagilat.
Political patronage is a national problem, not just in Bangsamoro. So ako, supporter kasi ako ng anti-political dynasty law. So maybe it's also something that has to be considered by the Bangsamoro Parliament, or the BTA, na pag-usapan rin ang isang anti-political dynasty law in the Bangsamoro region. Secondly, corruption is also at the local government level. So, importante rin na palakasin natin yung Bangsamoro local government code to ensure that the procurement processes are also very much transparent at the local level. And lastly, palakasin natin yung mga accountability institutions within the Bangsamoro Parliament, Commission on Audit, no? Ombudsman, the Regional Ombudsman, no? Para siguraduhin lang na maayos, no, yung ating governance. At yung mga may katiwalian ay nakukulong rin o napaparusahan. So yun po yung Robredo position with regards to this issue. Thank you.
Congressman Teddy Bagilat. Next, Ms. Samira Gutok.
Thank you, Sir Steve Mastura. Alam natin po, traditional elders, as a former corruption anti-watchdog leader here, kailangan po yung traditional leaders, ulama, are part and organic of an anti-corruption watchdog system. So paano po sila ay vanguard or partner, organic partner ng Sirat al-Mustaqim or this moral governance nga na framework ng Bangsamoro from the barangay level up to the regional, even national level when we use national projects, di ba po, or funds. So incentivized reporting, paano po maging organic members of a, how do you call, reporting council, let me echo yung bilis kilos data, public data open, freely available, and downgradable, downloadable, napakahirap po ng telco presence sa amin. So Wi-Fi should be accessible as far as sa mga bundok, dapat po user-friendly, dapat po may one-stop shop ang mga tao para po hindi nahirapan pumunta to report, no? Corruption, make strong public parties or political parties.
Ms. Amira Gutok. And then finally, we'll hear from Mr. Sonny Melencio. Go ahead, sir.
Na pinag-uusapan sa widespread pa itong patronage, it means that we have failed. Hindi nawawala. We have failed because we have not implemented the anti-political dynasty law. Na kailangan natin para it's coming from that. Yan sa matagal na panahon, they can do away with it. So nananatili yan. So unless we implement an anti-political dynasty law, this is a constitutional provision na hindi natin implement, and it's a failure ng ating buong Kongreso, then we really have a problem. So let me tell the Bangsamoro people, show us the way. Implement an anti-political dynasty law, and perhaps mapapahiyan.
Po, Mr. Sonny Melencio. And then we'll move on to our next question. The question is from the Private Education Assistance Committee. Ang tanong po para sa inyong lahat is, what is your candidate's education agenda for the Bangsamoro, especially given the poor performance of the region in various assessment instruments? So the first to respond will be Congressman Teddy Bagilat.
For Lenny Robredo, education is very, very crucial for the development of the country. No? So nationally, ang gusto niya talaga taasan yung budget for education, no? From 3%, no, equivalent of the GDP, to 6%. And that would also translate when it comes to ensuring na yung mga block grants natin na binibigay sa Bangsamoro government is used for education. Kasi even if education is within the ambit of powers of the Bangsamoro Parliament, pero malaki rin ang maitutulong ng national government when it comes to ensuring that there is funding, there is technical support for education in the Bangsamoro region. Aside from that, kinakailangan talagang palakasin rin yung participation ng kabataan when it comes to governance, no, in the Bangsamoro, making sure that there are capacity building programs, empowerment programs for the youth, para sila na mismo makipaglaban, no, doon sa kanilang karapatan sa quality education within the Bangsamoro government. Thank you very much.
Salamat po, Congressman Teddy Bagilat. We'll now hear from Ms. Amira Gutok.
The highest return of investment is on early childhood education. So napakalaki po ng dropout rate, napaka-low performance ang amin po sa Bangsamoro. May I also involve a preferential treatment for the Lumads, Badjaws, and others na napakalayo po ang access sa kanila. So Barangay Teachers Program ay napaka-importante po. Suporta po sa ating madrasa at paano ma-fast track po yung benefits of our teachers. Sila po ay frontliners natin. Bakit po nahihirapan pa sila pumunta sa mga ATM? Sila pa ay nahihirapan minsan sa safety nila. So kailangan siguro may logistics po doon. So yun po yung madrasa, yung efficiency natin of releasing our cash, no, to our public schools. And of course, if not private schools, masuportahan din sila barangay program so that we can access ito mga malalayo dito sa ating educational system.
At Ms. Samira Gutok, next we'll hear from Mr. Sonny Melencio.
Yes, this is precisely why we need the national government to na gumawa ng comprehensive education plan na magagamit ng mga regions, especially dun sa barn areas. Like the Constitution says that we should give priority to education sa ating budgeting, pero it's not happening because we're giving the priority to debt servicing. 20 to 40% of our budget goes to that. So asikasuhin natin yan kasi and then let's make sure na yung mga Bangsamoro areas, yung malalayo, kasi kami nababahala, lumang area, sa halip na tulungan natin ma-set up yung education system doon ay sila pa ang pinapaalis, pinapasara natin, binobomba yung communities, kaya maraming displays. So let's really make sure na education ay mabigyan natin ng priority, libreng edukasyon, especially dyan sa barn areas, magbigay tayo ng maraming mga scholarship, magkaroon tayo ng malaking programa sa pagtatayo ng mga schools doon sa mga far-flung areas para po makatulong sa kanila.
Okay. Salamat po, Mr. Sonny Melencio. Next, we'll hear from Senator Coco Pimentel.
Well, napakahalaga po ng education para kay Senator Manny Pacquiao. Kasi ngayon nakikita nga niya yung paano siya dinidiscriminate. Sinasabi sa kanya, hindi nakapag-aral yan. Ang hindi alam ng ating mga kababayan, edukado po si Senator Manny Pacquiao, pero iba lang yung sistemang nadaanan niya. Alternative learning system yun. Hindi katulad na yung alam natin na usual na paraan. So ganyan po kahalaga ang edukasyon. So buhusan natin ng pera or assistance ang lahat ng education programs nationwide and including sa BARM. That's why I congratulate the BARM regional government for also prioritizing their Ministry of Basic, Higher and Technical Education sa kanilang budget. But katulad na sinabi ko kanina, nothing should prevent national government from helping regional government, lalo na sa larangan ng edukasyon. So magsalita lang po sila. Anong additional assistance na kailangan nila, the Manny Pacquiao administration would be most willing to assist in the name of education.
Okay, salamat po, Senator Coco Pimentel. And finally, we'll hear from Secretary Manny Piñol.
I think this question, Christian, misses the fact that BARM is an autonomous government. Therefore, ang posisyon namin dyan, hayaan natin yung BARM na mag-device at mag-design ng kanilang mga programa on education. At kung kinakailangan nila ng additional support, then it should be given to them. Look, kami sa aming partido, we really would like to see the BARM succeed. Because ito yung ating model our desired federal setup of government. Sapagkat kapag nagtagumpay yung BARM, doing things their own way, and they are able to show to the whole country that a system of government like this is successful or could be successful, then we will have a perfect model. So ang sagot namin dyan, hayaan mo natin taga-BARM to do things themselves. At kung kinakailangan na ng additional tulong, that's the time we step in.
Oh, Secretary Manny Piñol, so at this point, it's the turn of the different stakeholders to directly ask their questions, which have been pre-recorded. Each of the speakers, again, will have 1 minute each to respond. Each of them will have 1 minute to respond. Now, throughout the forum, the sequence of responses will follow a rotating alphabetical order para po kanina based on the last names of our speakers. So the first to ask a question is women's rights and peace advocate Nina Rayana Bajin Imlan.
Nakikita natin ngayon, divided pa rin yung iba't ibang sector sa Bangsamoro in terms of protection mechanisms for women, no? Halimbawa na lang, pinakauna yung controversial na anti-child marriage law, no? May mga sectors pa rin in the BARM that register different views on the law. So kahit yung very basic na protection mechanisms for women that we should all advocate for, in my opinion, ay nakikita natin na may iba't ibang backlash from other sectors of within the BARM. No? So ano yung stand dito ng presidentiables? Yun yung gusto kong malaman. At paano nila mamemary yung iba't ibang mga ideas, kultura, at saka mga religious beliefs ng mga naninirahan sa BARM para maprotektahan yung karapatan at kapakanan ng mga babae.
Okay, the first to respond to that question will be former Congressman Teddy Bagilat. Go ahead, sir.
Yeah. Si President Robrero is fully supportive of RA 11596. No, dati na niyang pinagalaban ang children's rights, no? We believe that kinakailangan talaga ng malawakang consultation doon sa mga maaapektuhan ng batas. Kasama na dyan yung mga magulang, yung mga solemnizing officers. Of course, definitely our imams have to be consulted para tanggapin nila yung kahalagaan nitong batas. No? Importante rin, I think, yung pagpapalakas rin ng ating reproductive health programs because child marriages are also an offshoot of child pregnancies. At hindi lang to problema sa Bangsamoro, buong Pilipinas. No? Usually, ang nangyayari pag may nabuntis na bata, ang pinakasolusyon na lang, no, ay ikasal. No? So importante rin siguro yung ating RH programs, bigyan ng pansin. But definitely, consultations talaga sa ating mga stakeholders para yung implementation ng batas na ito ay mabisa at mapapatupad talaga. Maraming salamat po.
Okay, salamat po Congressman Teddy Bagilat. Next, we'll have Ms. Samira Gutok.
Thank you, Nina. Of course, we recognize that the CMPL laws on marriage, family relations are also governed by local, but we also have a national right now. So one of the things we can do as BARM, Bangsamoro, is to really promote childhood education and that we can empower ourselves as women so that we can make choices. We can always say no, di ba, to our mothers or families na, oy, ayoko pa. So we are, napaka high-tech na ngayon. There's Wi-Fi uploadable information. Kaya talagang pinupush ko at namin yung Wi-Fi, yung talagang telco access. Wi-Fi should be an empowering tool for women to know and young women to know their rights over their bodies and their lives. So yes, nirecognize natin na may uniqueness tayo sa kultura natin at pagrespeto sa parents natin. But we also have a choice as young women, no? Dapat mayroon ding advisory ang babae kung talagang oo siya sa isang marriage. So, childhood education, Islamic education, i-complement tayo sa modern education, integrated educational system.
Maraming salamat, Ms. Samira Gutok. Next, Mr. Sonny Melencio.
Yes, Cagliotti actually made a statement and he was very glad that itong batas na ito on criminalizing child marriage ay naipasad with, I think malaki yung nagawa dito ng ating mga kasama like si Risa, Senator Risa. And this also came after yung pagkakapasa naman ng increasing the age of statutory rape and age of consent from 12 years to 16 years. These are all consistent doon sa Convention on the Rights of the Child na tayo ay isa sa mga signatory. Kaya ang tingin ko, let us view this not as a police matter. Kailangan natin ng comprehensive program and services. And I know sa batas nakalagay na kailangan mag-participate ang civil society at saka mga organizations, NGOs with child rights and human rights advocacies para matiyak yung implementation nito. But I think it's also kailangan natin tiyakin na para maipatupad ito ay ma-develop natin yung mga communities ng Bangsamoro and then IPs because the world doesn't end after puberty. May career. Kung mag-develop yung career ng mga kabataan, malaki.
Okay. Salamat po, Mr. Sonny Melencio. Next, Senator Coco Pimentel.
Kami po ni Senator Manny Pacquiao, belonging to PDP Laban, the party. We believe in human dignity, among others. So, ayaw na ayaw po namin yung mga yung discrimination. We are against discrimination. So at pero kung mapansin natin yung Bangsamoro Organic Law, marami nakapasok na mga provisions doon at mga konsepto, mga ideas doon to prevent discrimination against women, against young people, against differently abled, against minorities, against even against non-Moros. So lahat po ng mga sections na yon na the reserved seat for women, reserved seat for the youth and the other reserved seats, we have to honor, implement, respect the provision. And I hope na pagdating na po ng real parliament, pagpili ng mga party list representatives nila na marami-rami sa parlamento, some will be women's rights organization, some will be youth organization, so that definitely meron pong magdala ng kausa ng kababaihan.
Okay. Salamat po, Senator Coco Pimentel. Next, we'll have Secretary Manny Piñol.
Let it be known that Senator Panfilo Lacson voted in favor of the passage of the Anti-Child Marriage Law. Considering the passage of this law and with the penalties to be imposed for the violations, and given that the law recognizes no exception, the implementation is inevitable. However, there are certain nuances that stand in the path of its full implementation, like custom, tradition, and culture of our Muslim brothers, and even the indigenous people's tribes. And so there is the right to religious freedom as guaranteed by the Constitution. Thus, a difficult balancing act must be made between the two. A middle ground should be reached where implementation will not defeat the spirit and letter of the law, and at the same time, not to be offensive to one's religious freedom and belief. We also propose massive information campaign.
Okay, salamat po, Secretary Manny Piñol. Next, the next question will come from filmmaker Gutierrez Teng Mangansakan. He's the convener of the Bangsamoro LGBT Network.
Dito sa BARM, for the last few months or even years, may napapansin kaming paglaki ng kaso ng mga human rights violation, pati violence and discrimination sa mga members ng LGBT community. Naging marahas pa nga yung ibang mga insidente. At dahil dito, nangangamba kami sa magiging kinabukasan ng LGBT community sa BARM kung patuloy na ganito yung mangyayari. So ang malaking tanong ko sa mga presidentiables ay kung ano yung commitment nila to promote and protect LGBT rights as embodied sa kabuuan nga ng human rights sa BARM. Kasi yung BARM, sinasabi nila, committed sila sa human rights, sa pag-protect ng human rights. Pero mukhang in actuality, hanggang salita lang yung mga pronouncements na doon. Hindi pa natin nakikita yung tunay na implementasyon ng mga hakbang para maprotektahan yung mga rights ng minorities, including the LGBT minorities sa BARM. So ano ba yung magiging hakbang at ano yung magiging programs ng national government kung nagkataon kayo yung mahalal bilang presidente? At paano niyo ito susugoduing mag-redown ito hanggang sa regional level, especially sa amin dito sa BARM?
Okay, the first to respond will be Ms. Samira Gutok.
As you know, thank you so much, Attorney, Brother Teng. National Human Rights Commission has to work closely under jurisdiction yang Bangsamoro HR. Although so much technical support is still needed, we can devise our programs accordingly so that our cultures and traditions can be also complemented by the so-called education support from HR international laws that are or documents that can be indigenized, localized, put into our dialect. Alam mo, Teng, I've stood no against hate crimes mismo sa Mindanao State University Gymnasium where we had forums related to this. Pero sadly, Teng, wala tayong budgets for such activities. And so HR, inclusion, how this can be put into our local lingo, local language and activities sa barangay and academe, yan po ang isang dapat tutukan natin.
Okay, salamat Samira. Next, we'll have Mr. Sonny Melencio.
Si Caliode, galit sa hate crime. Akala ko mukhang nag-trending yung kanyang anak na LGBT at kayo po paano niya hinahandle yan. I think this will also show doon sa handling niya dito. Kasi talagang yung hate crime, yung crime talagang dapat na anuhin yan, imbestigahan yan, at saka hulihin, at saka i-prosecute yung mga gumawa niyan. So that has to be done. Ngayon, kailangan nating ipasa yung long-delayed sexual orientation and gender identity expression, SOGI bill, na aparte doon sa how to deal with the discrimination against the LGBTQI+ na mga kababayan natin. At saka yung legislation against hate speech na dapat na talagang maiwasan, maturuan natin na hindi dapat ganyan ang gawin. And I think even on the human rights, let's create a division doon sa human rights that dealing with the promotion and protection of the rights of the LGBTQI+.
Salamat po, Mr. Sonny Melencio. Next, we'll have Senator Coco Pimentel.
So, salamat dun sa tanong. This is another case of discrimination. At gaya ng nasabi ko kanina, the Manny Pacquiao administration will be strong against discrimination. No? Ayaw natin yan based on our belief on human dignity. Although, masasabi ko, anticipated na rin po ito na if there are human rights violations in the BARM, sabi sa batas, there should be a human rights commission. And I have been informed na nabuo na po ito. And let us avail of the services of this commission para makita natin if it is working or not. Kasi part po yan ang feedback process ng mga legislator. We need to get feedback on what is happening on the ground. Yung theory ba namin ay in reality ay natutupad. Pero in the cases of discrimination, pwede pa rin po kayong tumakbo sa national government because this is a basic human right. No one should be discriminated against.
Salamat po, Senator Coco Pimentel. Ang susunod naman po na sasagot, si Secretary Manny Piñol.
Let us once again be reminded that the BARM is an autonomous regional government. So hayaan natin silang mag-design, mag-device ng pamamaraan upang maiwasan itong discrimination na ito. But the Lacson administration will have an official stand on this. Under the Lacson administration, there will be no gender discrimination, especially in law enforcement. LGBTQI plus hate crimes must stop. It's time to break the culture of impunity and silence. There must be a concrete action plan for the protection against SOGI-based violence and promotion of the rights of LGBTQI plus community in the entire BARM and the entire country as a whole. Thank you.
Piñol. Next, Congressman Teddy Bagilat.
Yes, concretely, yung passage of the anti-discrimination law of which Vice President Lenny Robredo and I were principal authors dun sa House of Representatives. No? Importante rin siguro hikayatin natin yung local government units, private sector, civil society na meron silang help desk. And to also try to empower the Regional Human Rights Office, the Bangsamoro Women's Commission, the Commission on Human Rights at the national level, na mag-establish ng isang redress mechanism for aggrieved LGBTQ community. Isama rin doon sa Regional Peace and Development Plan, ang LGBT issues and agenda. But really, most of the discrimination against LGBT is also cultural-based. So importante rin talaga magkaroon ng malawakang consultation sa mga stakeholders, sa mga moral gatekeepers natin para mapatupad yung pagpapataguyod ng karapatan ng LGBTQ community doon sa Bangsamoro region. Thank you very much.
Okay, salamat po Congressman Teddy Bagilat. The next question will come from Samarudin Samsudin, a youth leader from Mamasapano, Maguindanao.
I am an active youth leader here in Mamasapano, one of the areas in SPMS box where most conflict affected areas happen or occur dito po sa aming lugar. Ano ba yung magiging mga programa para sa mga kabataang Bangsamoro dito, specifically dito sa SPMS box? We all know that most of the time nagkakaroon dito ng armed conflict, which is ang mga kabataan, nagkakaroon ng mga human rights violations. So paano ba maiibsan, paano ba natin ipagpapatuloy yung mga peace process ng giyera? And ano yung mga programa para sa mga kabataang Bangsamoro from the national government na mas palawakin pa ang kanilang inclusive na participation in the national government?
Okay, so the first to respond will be Mr. Sonny Melencio.
Well, itong problema na binanggit natin, especially dun sa SPMS box na yan, na handun, I think that where it's focused yung anti-terrorism law. But right now, it's actually focused doon sa mga CBP and PAGPM. But basically, dyan yan ina-address. And I think we also have to ensure na yung implementation niya dyan sa mga areas na yan, I respect the human rights of those concerned. Kaya may problema tayo dito sa anti-terror law na pwede yung warrantless arrest at pwede yung mga makulong ka ng 24 days na pwedeng doon eh, mag-plant na kung ano-ano sa'yo at talalo kang mahirapan. So, So ano yan, isang malaking bagay yan. But we believe that the way to deal with this problem is to have a wholesale, you know, a full development of approach na kailangan i-develop natin yung community at yung mga pangangailangan ng kabataan sa lugar.
Salamat po, Mr. Sonny Melencio. We'll now call on Senator Coco Pimentel.
Well, under a Pacquiao presidency, I would suggest to the president na yung National Youth Commission natin should have more involvement in the Bangsamoro, lalo na to sa mga youth leaders sa kabataan. Sabihin ko, hinahanap-hanap kayo ron. O di dapat magbuo sila ng programa na talagang i-involve ang ating mga kabataan even in the Bangsamoro. So they will feel that they're part of not only the regional government but the national government and the country. But also, ulitin ko, there are provisions in the Bangsamoro Organic Law, a reserved seat for the youth. In the proportional representation, pwede rin magpatakbo ang mga youth party lists in the parliament. So I'm excited for the parliamentary election para makita po natin ito in action. So sa mga kabataan ngayon sa Bangsamoro, start organizing yourselves para you can be well represented in the parliament pagdating po ng panahon.
Coco Pimentel. Next, we'll have Secretary Manny Piñol.
I will recommend to the President that the program which I started when I was Governor of Cotabato, the Children of Peace program, be replicated. Ano ito? We gathered together bright high school graduating students, Muslim, Cristiano, at saka tribo, and we organized them into a group called Children of Peace. We exposed them to areas where there is peace and development, and when they came home, they actually finished their studies and some of them are professionals right now. This could be naging po, galing po kawar dito, itong programang ito. And this could be replicated not only in the barn but also the whole of Mindanao to promote greater understanding among the youth of Mindanao and the country right now, especially the barn. Kasi sila yung magiging future leaders ng ating bansa. So yun po yung aming magiging special program for the youth of the Bangsamoro.
Manny Piñol. Next, we'll have Congressman Teddy Bagilat.
Yes, see, VP Lenny Robreno is very much concerned with the welfare ng youth caught in armed conflicts. Kinakailangan magkaroon ng partnership with the Bangsamoro government na magkaroon ng development plan for the youth no, caught in armed conflict. Ganun rin no, yung protection of children caught in armed conflict. In fact, mayroon isang batas ngayon. Sinuportahan to ni Lenny Robredo, kasama na rin po tayo dito, yung emergency relief assistance to children during emergencies. No? Mahalaga rin siguro, tignan natin yung kanilang mental health, no? Yung mga youth na caught in armed conflict. There's this new national mental health law supported by Lenny and myself in Congress. And when we talk about youth empowerment, no, napakahalaga kay Lenny Robredo yung edukasyon talaga. That's the key to development no, of our young. And in terms of participation, gusto ni Lenny Robredo na siguraduhin yung full implementation of the Sanggunian Kabataan Reform Law no, para talaga ma-empower yung ating kabataan na ipaglaban din yung kanilang karapatan. Maraming salamat.
Maraming salamat, Congressman Teddy Bagilat. Finally, we'll have Ms. Samira Gutok.
Full activation po ng mekanismo ng MILF at ng gobyerno / AFP-PNP peacekeeping mechanisms. Dapat po ma-leverage po yan. Talaga down the grassroots, barangay keeps peacekeeping. Kailangan po siguro talagang lagyan po sila ng gasolina, sasakyan. Alam ko po yan bilang former PNP advisor ng Lanao Sur. Ang napakalaking bagay po that the youth are also enticed to join the security sector, why not apply sa PMA o kaya sa PNP Academy para kasama na rin po tayo sa ating security sector. Future Bangsamoro Generals, can you imagine tayo rin ay mamamana natin itong pagtindig ng security. Of course, BOCTEC, access to youth development budgeting, hindi lang the Office of the under the Parliament Minister tayo, kundi talagang budget na autonomiya na kailangan natin bilang kabataang managers on the ground, kailangan natin yon for our youth programs. I'd like to acknowledge so much efforts of the NGO, International Community, International Alert. Kailangan supportahan din yung monitors to keep on monitoring us.
Ms. Samira Gutok. Now, the next question will come from Mr. Leticio Datuwata. Siya po ang Supreme Tribal Chief ng Timuay Justice and Governance.
ano yung kanilang aksyon, no, doon sa protection ng ancestral domain ng mga katutubong Taluray at Lambangian dahil doon sa issue ng Bangsamoro Transition Authority na cease and desist order na ancestral domain processing dito sa loob ng BARM. Yun nga, kahit na napasok naman at isa sa mga provision doon sa Bangsamoro Transition Bangsamoro Organic Law, ang delineation of ancestral domain of the non-Moro indigenous people shall be respected and recognized, yung nakalagay sa ball. Pero kabaliktaran, yung nangyayari ay ang pag-issue ng Bangsamoro Transition Authority ng cease and desist order noong September 25, 2020. Ano yung gawin ng isang manalong presidente kung sakali siya yung mananalo? Kasi rampant itong issue ng land grabbing, nagkaresulta ng pagkamatay ng mga leader at mga membro ng komunidad sa loob ng ancestral domain ng Taluray at sa Kalambangan.
The first to respond to that question will be Senator Coco Pimentel.
Sa katanungan, these are very serious allegations, no? And 1 minute would not be enough to answer the question. Merong land grabbing, may mga namamatay pa. Kung ganyan po ang feedback na matatanggap ng isang presidente, he will be personally involved na sa ganyang sitwasyon to look at the situation, why this is happening. But just to cite the law, meron tayo ritong article, although sinight na po na to ni Mr. Datuwata, the Bangsamoro government recognizes the rights of the indigenous peoples and shall adopt measures for the promotion and protection of their rights, the following rights, native titles. Kasama po yan doon. So tayo, ang Manny Pacquiao administration will enforce the law kung ano yung nasa law. Okay, so we will not allow a misinterpretation of the law, lalo na it will result to land grabbing and to killings. Hindi po mangyayari yan under the presidency of Senator Manny.
Thank you, Senator Coco Pimentel. Next, we'll have Secretary Manny Piñol.
While the presidential candidate of Reforma NPC recognizes the autonomy of the Bangsamoro, it also believes that a national law like the IPRA cannot be superseded by a local ordinance or local law. Therefore, ang position ng Reforma NPC is to implement the IPRA until such time the Bangsamoro is able to pass a law that would adopt the IPRA in the context of the BARM. So ang position ng ating presidential candidate dyan, i-implementa yung IPRA law and let the Tidurais and the Lambiang tribe of UPI, Maguindanao, get their fair share of their ancestral domain and be protected.
Okay, salamat po, Secretary Manny Piñol. Next, we'll have Congressman Teddy Bagilat.
Ito talaga personal na aking advokasya, no? Yung pagkilala ng indigenous people's rights within the Bangsamoro government, particularly yung kanilang ninunong lupa at yung right to self-determination nila doon sa ninunong lupa nila. And Lenny Robredo has been very supportive of provisions in the Bangsamoro law with regards to indigenous people's welfare and rights, no? Concretely or specifically, sinusuportahan namin yung passage ng Bangsamoro IP Code, working with the Bangsamoro government para palakasin yung Ministry of Indigenous People's Affairs para pangalagaan at protektahan nila yung karapatan ng mga katutubo. Also, working with the Bangsamoro government para meron tayong tribal university system para itaguyod yung indigenous knowledge systems and practices ng mga IPs, no? So importante talaga yung pagkilala ng mga karapatan ng mga katutubo doon sa loob ng Bangsamoro region. At yan ay priority rin ni Lenny Robredo. Maraming salamat po.
Salamat po, Congressman Teddy Bagilat. Next, we'll have Ms. Amira Gutok.
Sensitibo po ang Bangsamoro majority Muslim sa existence po ng ating mga minoridad na tribo at katutubo. Kaya isa po tayong author nung nasa ARM tayo ng IP Code. kaya lang hindi na ipasa. So ngayon po nasa barn law na po, nailaban po yan, yung pagkilala sa integrated tri-people educational system, sa land rights. Kailangan po yung arbitration, mediation na sistema ay talagang lagyan ng pondo po yan kung merong kailangan tracking, inventorying, and titling, and registry. Can you imagine po 17 or so down na land management agencies from national and local have to talk to each other, advised by an international group. So napaka tedious, nakakatakot po, kaya nga po nagkaroon ng rebellion because of land. And I would support legal scholarship for the Lumads and for the three tribes in Bangsamoro. Dapat ipaglaban po mismo ng ating tribal leaders ang kanilang proper proprietary rights and makilala ng Bangsamoro ito.
Po, Ms. Amira Gutok. And then finally, we'll hear from Mr. Sonny Melencio.
Si Calio, our President Calio Guzman, ay recognize yung halaga nitong Indigenous People's Rights Act, IPRA, one of the most progressive law of its kind. Ang problema lang dito yung implementation. Ngayon, naririnig ko, so it's not only the implementation, nagpapatuloy yung land grabbing, nagpapatuloy yung mga krimen, dapat may immediate action against that. And we also have to speed up the granting of the certificates of ancestral domain titles para sa ating mga IPs. And then ensure na yung prinsipyo ng free, prior, and informed consent ay hindi binabiolate sa anumang agreement na ginagawa doon sa indigenous communities with a private interest, and revoke all unjustly imposed mining and other economic agreements that encroach on indigenous lands or have violated the principle of the FPIC, yung pre-prior and informed consent. And yun po, reparations doon sa mga nabiktima. Maraming salamat.
Maraming salamat po, Mr. Sonny Melencio. Next, we will have Ms. Arlene Sevilla. She is the chairperson of the Tawi-Tawi Alliance of Civil Society Organizations. Ito po yung tanong niya.
It is our concern because there is mining activity in the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region, especially in the province of Tawi-Tawi. What are your plans for those irresponsible miners who created or caused devastation and affected livelihood of fisher folks and agricultural farmers? How will you address unemployment in the Bangsamoro region and in the Philippines in general, especially our agricultural farmers and seaweed farmers and the fisher folks who are racing against time with porciners gathering and collecting aquatic resources, especially in the Sulu Seas?
Okay, maraming salamat sa katanungang iyon from Ms. Arlene Sevilla. So the first to respond is Secretary Manny Piñol.
Unang-una sa mining, yung aking principal, si Senator Ping Lacson, is an advocate for clean and responsible mining. Therefore, against kami dun sa open pit mining at iba pang nakakasira na pagmimina. Pangalawa, bilang tinatawag nilang agriculture advocate sa aming partido, yung pong inyong inihain na problema, eh meron na pong tayong nakadesign na programa dyan. Before I left the Department of Agriculture, ginawa na po natin yung master plan for agriculture and fisheries for the Bangsamoro region. And all that we need to do is revisit that master plan na ngayon po ay hawak ng MAFAR at ma-implementa po natin. Yun po yung resulta ng ating consultation na ginawa. I don't know if you were able to participate. Consultation po na ginawa natin na pati po yung mga taga-Sitangkay ay sumama po sa consultation na yun. So yun lang po ang ating i-revisit.
Manny Piñol. Next, we'll have Congressman Teddy Bagilat.
Madaming tanong, I'll focus on mining. Meron kasi kaming environmental agenda with Lenny Robredo. We are supporting the passage of a new mining law. Talagang ma-establish na yung mga no-go mining zones. whether prime agricultural lands or yung mga critical watersheds natin, o di kaya offshore quarrying, no, talagang na kailangan na pagbawalan. So we will work with the Bangsamoro government in terms of crafting a regional mining law also. Importante rin yung agrikultura. Whether you are a Cordilleran farmer or a farmer in the Bangsamoro region, hindi kami masyadong sumasang-ayon sa liberalization, no? Ibig sabihin yung importation of food. Kasi nagiging ano tayo eh, country of food importation. So kinakailangan talagang tulungan natin directly yung ating mga magkasaka, bigyan sila ng additional na kapital, bilangan sila ng crop insurance coverage, mag-invest tayo in agricultural infrastructure, farm-to-market roads, and irrigation systems. So yan po ang priority ni Lenny, tourism, and develop tourism in Bangsamoro as a source also of kabuhayan. Maraming salamat po.
Salamat po, Congressman Teddy Bagilat. Next, we'll have Ms. Amira Gutok.
Magsukul, Arlene. Bismillah. Of course, the protection and the benefit of our host community. Arlene, alam mo, yan ang pinaglalaban natin. When we were in ARM, we always wanted a compliance to environmental rules, either Tawi-Tawi mining bayan or wherever Liguasan or what province in the Bangsamoro. And of course, nationally, we will always push for responsible practices of environment. We want monitoring regularly by our environment ministry so that there is full compliance to environment sound methodologies. Paano tayo magkaroon ng employment, lalo pa yung fishery industry, water-based tayo dyan, Ma'am Arlene, tourism industry, syempre peace and order, inuna natin, normalisasyon, at yung ating pag-invest sa ating promotion, telco, wifi access, napaka importante niyan, Ma'am Arlene, for us officers, tourism, to be able to showcase to the world na pwede na pala tayong bisitahin na Bangsamoro.
Salamat, Ms. Amira Gutok. And then we'll hear from Mr. Sonny Melencio.
I think we have to craft a new mining law at hindi yung parang talagang mining law na nasasamantala yung ating mga natural resources, and not only that, nasisira yung ating environment. But in the meantime, let's ensure na may revenue yung communities na mayroong mining operation mula doon sa mga mining companies that can help them to develop until such time na ma-shift na natin, ma-close na natin yung mga mining companies na yan. And also we start with revoking all the unjustly imposed mining operations, yung nabanggit ko kanina, na mga nag-encroach doon sa indigenous land at hindi kinonsulta yung mga mamamayang IPs at yung mamamayang Bangsamoro na naroroon. And I think also, let's reorganize the DENR and make it the Department of Environment and Indigenous Filipinos to make sure na yung ating ginagawa ng ito na yan ay hindi pagsira ng kalikasan, kundi pagbubuo pa nito.
Thank you. Salamat po, Mr. Sonny Melencio. And then next, Senator Coco Pimentel.
Nagsusumbong sa atin si Arlene Sibilia. Sabi niya may mga irresponsible miners who created or caused devastation. Ang masasabi ko lang po, under a Pacquiao presidency, the full force of the law will be applied to these people because there is violation of the law. And then pagdating po siguro sa jobs generation, mining should be the last option. I think it's proven the manufacturing is the best way to generate employment, and then concentrate din tayo sa agriculture natin, especially on food production. Yung mga mina, yung mga riches ng ating bansa, mineral resources, if we are not yet ready to add value to them at puro para lang tayong colony na nag-export sa ating colonizer ng ating mga raw materials, wag na muna natin galawin. Let us wait for ang apo natin, apo or apo ng apo natin, when we are ready to add value to this minerals na saka na natin sila talagang fully gamitin. But in the meantime, all activities exploiting our land must follow environmental laws.
Okay, salamat po, Senator Coco Pimentel. Ngayon, tutungo po tayo sa final video question. Okay, ito po ang tanong ay galing kay Mr. Dreza Lininding of the Moro Consensus Group.
Kami po sa Marawi ay mahigit 4 na taon na hindi pa pinapayagang bumalik dun sa sinasabing 24 barangays. may tour na pinayagan at binigyan ng paintulot na magpagawa ng bahay, building permits, pero yung majority pa rin ng mga barangays ay hindi pa rin namin napapasukan or wala access. So sakaling kayo po ang maupo, papayagan niyo po ba itong mga residente ng 24 barangays na makabalik unconditionally? So yun po yung question natin. Ang second question natin ay ngayon po ay naipasa na po sa mababang kongreso at saka sa Senado yung Marawi Compensation Bill. Pero ito po ay wala pang appropriation or wala pang pondo. Kung sakali po na kayo ang maluklok na Pangulo ng Pilipinas, susuportahan niyo po ba itong Marawi Compensation Bill na malagyan ng pondo para po mabayaran natin yung mga apektadong residente na nasira noong Marawi Siege?
Ang tanong na is Congressman Teddy Baginat.
Well, definitely, no, Lenny Robredo will support the passage of the Marawi Compensation Law. In fact, priority ni Lenny Robredo ang rehabilitation, no, agara o speedy rehabilitation of Marawi. Palagi siyang andun eh. At hindi lang nagbibisita for EPAL purposes, pero talagang andun siya para tumulong. In fact, meron siyang housing program dun sa Marawi at talagang tinutulungan niya yung mga evacuees, no. Importante rin kay Lenny Robredo magkaroon ng partnership with the Bangsamoro government para talagang mapapast track, no, itong rehabilitation of Marawi. And definitely sa kanya kinakailangan talagang sagutin natin yung ugat ng mga ng dahilan kung bakit tayo nagkaroon ng Marawi siege. So for Lenny, importante po yung speedy saka yung passage ng Marawi Compensation Law. Thank you.
Samira Gutok.
Nasabi po kagabi ni Scott doon sa Muslim Forum stakeholders na prioridad ang Marawi rehabilitation. Di syempre kaya tayo sumusulong po senatorial is to include the Marawi framework push for the Senate to pass. Kasi hindi tayo nagkaroon ng oras to pass this law. The three C's on crisis, crisis calamity and COVID, which is the issue of the day. Pinupush natin yung Marawi. Definitely, it's not just about security, return, but also medical, paglibing sa ating mga kababayan. Walang ayuda at wala pong pagbigay assistance, no? Wala pong task force desk na pwedeng available sa every camp. So kailangan nasa batas po yan para malagyan ng pondo ang camp manager, swelduhan sila, at yung right to return kung kailangan ng executive order para itong so-called military or government estate or reservation, ang Marawi hectares ay mailagay sa tuwid, ibigay it, i-award ng DARPA or land the agency to the rightful owners.
Okay. Thank you, Ms. Amira Gutok. Next, Mr. Sonny Melencio.
Yes, bawat araw na hindi nakakabalik yung ating mga Bangsamoro sa kanilang tahanan, ibig sabihin, bawat araw-araw na injustice yan. Kaya kailangan talagang gawa na agad ng paraan yan. And in the meantime, let's make sure na kung nasaan sila, ay i-provide natin sila ng mga necessities na kailangan nila. Kasi nabanggit kanina, maraming mga Bangsamoro na nasa labas na ng barn. And this is precisely what it is, yung inaharap natin. So they need support, and we really have to make sure that we have we are the national government is supporting them. Si Calliotti ay nagsabi na maglalaan siya ng 10 billion pesos para doon sa reconstruction ng Marawi City. And this is lagpas pa doon sa ilalaan doon sa Black Fund grant doon sa Bangsamoro Authority. Now, this will come from different sources, one of which ay yung wealth tax na binabanggit namin. Tax the richest 300 to 500 Filipino na pinanginita dito sa at gamitin sa mga ganyang development plan.
Okay, salamat po, Mr. Sonny Melencio. Next, Senator Coco Pimentel.
Ito pong Marawi Compensation Bill ay pumasa sa Senado 23-0. Ibig sabihin nun, pa ako at saka si Senator Manny Pacquiao ay bumoto in favor of this bill. So if Senator Manny Pacquiao becomes president, eh, siguradong he will look for funding for this bill. Kasi compensation po ito for the loss na sira ang bahay, sira ang mga property na nakawan. Hindi rin makabalik eh kung hindi niyo ma-rebuild eh, yung lugar. So the people affected must be compensated. This is a very unfortunate event. Calamity ang tawag natin dito. Tulungan tayong mga hindi naapektuhan ng kalamidad ay dapat willing tulungan parate yung apektado ng kalamidad. Para pagdating naman ng panahon na tayo ang nangangailangan ng tulong, handa naman silang tulungan tayo. So this is our way of bayanihan, my dear friends. Marawi is an unfortunate incident nangyari yon. So sa 2017, we have to help them fully, all out support.
Okay, salamat po, Senator Coco Pimentel. And then finally, Mr. Manny Piñol.
Sa kaalaman po ng lahat, si Senador Panfilo Lacson po ay bumoto pabor sa Senate Bill 2420 or Marawi Siege Compensation Act of 2021. At meron po siyang opisyal na pahayag. Kung ako ang inyong bibigyan ng pagkakataon na mamumunod sa ating bansa, uunahin natin ang comprehensive rehabilitasyon ng Marawi City at iba pang apektadong bayan sa Lanao del Sur. Hindi lamang natin bubuhusan ng pondo at pansin ang rehabilitasyon sa infrastruktura, sisiguraduhin din natin na matutugunan ang pangangailangan ng halos 86,000 na nawalan ng tirahan dahil sa gulo sa Marawi, kasama na ang 4,229 na pamilya na nasa transitory or temporary sites hanggang sa kasalukuyan. Ang tugon natin ay sasaklaw sa kabuhayan, edukasyon at kalusugan, hindi lamang sa infrastruktura. Titiyakin natin na ang mga apektadong mamamayan ay may bahay at buhay na babalikan sa pamamagitan ng Marawi Compensation Act.
Okay. Maraming salamat po, Secretary Manny Piñol. Alam niyo po, napakarami pong tanong na pumapasok dito sa ating mga live streaming na nangyayari, no? So ang gagawin po natin, dahil hindi po kasi yung oras natin, we will collect all those questions and then we will send them to the guests, to our speakers, and then we will publish the responses to those questions. So at this point, we will now move on to our next part in our forum. Here we have a panel of experts asking questions to our guest speakers who will each have, again, 1 minute to respond. First, I would like to introduce Attorney Benedicto Bacani. He is the Executive Director of the Institute for Autonomy and Governance. We will also have Professor Francisco Pancho Lara. He is the Senior Peace and Conflict Advisor of International Alert Philippines. He is the author of the book, Insurgents, Clans, and States, Political Legitimacy and Resurgent Conflict in Muslim Mindanao. And then our third panelist is Ms. Amina Rasul Bernardo. She is the President of the Philippine Center for Islam and Democracy. So welcome po sa ating mga panelists. The first to ask his question is Attorney Benny Bacani.
Magandang salamat, Christian, at magandang umaga po. Yung pong extension ng transition, in-extend na po yan until 2025, pati ho yung election. Dahil nga alam natin na kailangan ng mas mahabang panahon upang matapos ho yung mga kailangan gawin, no, during the transition. But on the other hand, sa debate ho nung extension sa Kongreso, yung mga oppositors ho were saying na ang problema dyan, masyadong exclusive yung process at substance, yung mga policies, dahil nga MILF dominated ito, no? Nasa peace process tayo. It is only through elections na magiging more inclusive yung governance. No? Kaya ang tanong ito, kung mahalal ho bang presidente yung inyong mga kandidato, open ba sila to extend anew the transition period beyond 2025 if the BTA makes representation na hindi nila matatapos, no, yung mga dapat gawin, no? At ano ho ba talagang matimbang dito? Demokrasya election or peace process, no? Yun ho yung aking katanungan ho sa ating mga guests.
Salamat po, Attorney Benny. Ang una pong sasagot is Ms. Amira Gutok.
sa discussion nila po ni CM Murat, which I was lucky to listen to po, Sir Benny, was there was an affirmation by ISCO Bilisquilos to have a continuity, no, of services, continuity, if possible, of leadership even. Although hindi siya detalyado, there's no discussion of elections, an extension or appointments or so. Pero the generic word of continuity para may stabilidad na maiproseso yung normalisasyon at kung ano na pang doables ng ating current Bangsamoro ay kinikilala po ng Bilisquilos. Kung either peace process, alam natin po mabigat po yun na question po, Sir Ben. We crossed the bridge, of course, for a more detailed discussion with Bilisquilos and the MILF and the stakeholders as a whole. Importante po, may proseso po where the, even the MNLF are part of the discussion. Other groups, women, are also part of this decision-making process.
Okay, salamat po, Ms. Amira Gutok. Next is Mr. Sonny Melencio.
I think hindi maganda yung parang dichotomy na election o kaya yung pagtagalin pa yung process. Merong itinakda na yan eh. Now, there should be a mechanism where we can consult with the Bangsamoro mismo, Bangsamoro people, kung paano yung gagawin dito. There's plebiscite, there's referendum. Pwede nating gawin yan instead of parang ipagpatuloy na alam ko marami na rin issue. Kanina lumilitaw yung mga issue kaugnay noong sa Transition Authority exclusive din at hindi inclusive. So we have to do something about that. At yung ganun ka serious na bagay na extend mo yung sinasabi na ng organic law, should have a process of consultation with the Bangsamoro people themselves. So I say, let's look at referendum, let's look at the plebiscite, at tingnan natin kung anong kagustuhan.
Okay, salamat po, Mr. Sonny Melencio. Next, Senator Coco Pimentel.
The Bangsamoro Organic Law, as I stated earlier, is a peace document, at the same time a democratic influenced government. So ang gawin na lang po natin ganito, kasi by 2025, mga naka-anim na taon na po yung mga members ng BTA kung maire-retain pa sila. And I don't think they can make an excuse na they're not ready. They have not yet enacted the necessary codes. Ngayon kasi, we just gave them the benefit of the doubt because kami mismo sa lawmaking, we felt it, the effect of the pandemic. Yung 2 years, there was really a slowdown in productivity. So kung naramdaman ko yan, naramdaman ng iba yan, let's assume na naramdaman din po yan at the level of the regional government. We gave them the benefit of the doubt. By 2025, we must be ready to fully implement the BOL, look at the parliamentary system in action in the Philippines.
Salamat po, Senator Coco Pimentel. Next, Secretary Manny Piñol.
Gusto ko lang po maintindihan ng lahat na doon sa extension to 2025, magkaiba pong positioning namin ng aking principal. Si Senator Ping Lacson was against it because of his belief that it should be based by sa law, sa batas. Ako naman, I base my recommendation for extension on real politics, no? Yung politika sa ground. But on the question of peace or democracy, peace process democracy, mukhang hindi maling hindi tamang premise yan, no? Because yung extension ng BTA to another 3 years after 2025 does not necessarily assure us of peace, no? So ang aming punto diyan, let the Bangsamoro people decide after 2025, no longer the president of the Philippines, no? Ang position ni Senator Panfilo Lacson, we have extended the BTA up to 2025. There is enough time for them to resolve all of the issues and prove themselves, which I believe tama ang punto na yun, yung time frame na yun. So ang aming position is no, we will not, the principal is not agreeable to another extension of another 3 years.
Okay, salamat po sa sagot na yan. Next, Congressman Teddy Bagilat.
Akin, hindi exclusive yung democratic process, no, saka yung peace process. Importante yung free and fair elections. para siguraduhin na meron tayong mga mahahalal na mga leaders na ipapatupad yung peace dividends, no, ng peace process, no. As to the extension of the BTA, ang sabi naman ni Lenny Robredo, we are open to discussing it by 2025. Hindi natin alam kung ano magiging sitwasyon by 2025. But for now, importante na talagang tignan natin yung 3-year roadmap. No, every year, dapat meron tayong mga milestones na na-achieve, whether it's the full decommissioning of the MILF forces or the development of the 6 MILF camps. No, importante na ang ating objective patungo pa rin doon sa full transition towards a Bangsamoro parliamentary government, no. And finally, siguro yung oversight, no, o yung monitoring, it really has to be inclusive to include other sectors and stakeholders. Thank you very much.
Salamat po, Congressman Teddy Bagilat. Paumanhin po sa mga guests natin, no. Medyo nag-extend po tayo ng konti dahil napaka dami po mga tanong at saka napaka-importante po ng issue. So, pasensya na po. Okay, so the next one to ask his question is Professor Pancho Lara. Go ahead, sir.
Hello. Good morning sa ating mga bisita. I'd like to ask a question regarding the normalization process. I suppose you will agree that, you know, the peace agreement put a lot of importance on decommissioning of weapons, both from the Comprehensive Agreement on the Bangsamoro and the Bangsamoro Organic Law. Now, despite that commitment to weapons, there is still a significant number of illicit weapons circulating in Mindanao and most especially in the Bangsamoro. At the moment, our estimate is about 55,000 unlicensed firearms only in the Bangsamoro. And there is also a national law that says that all weapons should be licensed, that is RA 10591, or else they will be deemed illegal. Yet, despite the peace agreement, people walk around with weapons that are unlicensed, including our peace partners, the MILF. So my question is, can you think of any new bold initiatives that will liquidate the presence of illicit weapons in Mindanao and neutralize those sources and holders of those illicit weapons?
Oh, for that question, Professor Pancho Lara, the first to respond is Mr. Sonny Milencio.
Alam mo yung problema na yan, I remember the CPLA problem. Kasi itong decommissioning na ito, a part of this is that decommissioning and conversion or integration of the members of the MILF into the BARM's internal security forces. But kahit dun sa CPLA, kahit dun sa MNLF, there was a problem kung paano yung integration. Kasi there were conditions set up. Like yung mga officials na may integrate dun sa AAP have to have college education or graduate pa nga. And then may age limit. And considering na itong mga lumaban na ito, bata pa sila, may tumandaan na dun sa struggle na yan, mahirap na ma-meet yan. So katulad nung sinasabi ko sa kaso ng MPLA, nagkalat yung mga armas. And for them to survive, hindi rin kasi nagtuloy-tuloy yung support na ibinibigay sa kanila sa community development para hindi lang ma-integrate sila doon sa security forces, kundi ma-integrate sila sa economic development. So binibenta nila yung armas na yan. So, okay. So the way to deal it is yung comprehensive development nila. Okay. Thank you.
Salamat po. Next, Senator Coco Pimentel.
Para hindi madagdaga na, sabi 55,000 at least, no? Para hindi madagdaga, we should take full advantage of our membership in the Arms Trade Treaty. Okay, at itong treaty pinasa ng Senado, bare minimum 16 votes. Buti na lang bumoto dyan si Senator Manny Pacquiao, he is the crucial vote dyan, kaya po naging member tayo dyan. So, and we can also learn best practices from these countries on how to minimize or prevent the illicit trade in firearms or conventional weapons. Ngayon yung nandun na sa Mindanao na calculated at 55,000, some of them are held by former combatants or rebels. So we have to really fully implement the decommissioning process. Around 40 to 42,000 ang target doon. I'm sure I have been informed na delay yung process. So to fully implement that process, so i-minus na natin dun yun, let us say, ma-surrender talaga yung firearms. The rest, siguro mga 10,000 would really be unlicensed firearms. So this would be police action. Okay, so, and then at the same time, we have to give the people reason no longer to be interested in firearms, in having firearms.
Okay, salamat po, Senator Coco. Next, Secretary Manny Piñol.
With full recognition of the autonomy of the Bangsamoro government and respect for its leaders, President Panfilo Lacson will see to it that a campaign by the police against loose firearms shall be conducted and will be much more intensified. All violators will face charges for violation of RA 101591, otherwise known as the Comprehensive Firearms and Ammunitions Registration Act. But we will leave it to the Bangsamoro government to design a program that would hasten the decommissioning of these firearms because we recognize their powers of autonomy.
Secretary Piñol, next, Congressman Teddy Bagilat.
Doon sa decommissioning of the MILF forces, that's only going to be successful if we also have the socio-economic package. That's my experience with the Cordillera People's Liberation Army. That's also yung mga naririnig ko sa mga MNLF na mga brothers and sisters natin. Okay, decommissioning is there, but kung walang socio-economic and livelihood the package na promise sa kanila, hindi talaga mangyayari yung surrendering of firearms. Ngayon, kwento ito sa akin ng isang kaibigan kong politician sa Bangsamoro. We're always looking at the MNLF, MILF, may ibang forces when it comes to firearms. Pero actually, maraming mga loose firearms in the Bangsamoro is at the hands of political warlords. No? So sa amin ni Lely Robredo, importante rin talaga yung pagtutulak ng anti-political dynasty law because that limits the kapangyarihan ng mga political warlords in Bangsamoro. And perhaps with that, mababawasan din talaga yung rule of firearms or rule of violence in Bangsamoro. Thank you.
Okay, salamat po, Congressman Teddy Bagilat. And last to respond to this question, si Ms. Samira Gutok.
Of course, prevention of violence entails a very holistic approach, not just the defense and security, which is of course also a national, since one army, one PNP, kinikilala pa rin ng BOL, Bangsamoro government, at nasa taas. Minsan ang expertise at mismo ang go at saka push and leverage. Kaya dito pa lang sa level natin sa Bangsamoro, tinatrain pa lang natin yung hierarchy natin to manage a firearms management program. And I remember as a PNP army advisor, incentivize it, try to get the private armed groups to cooperate in a more stakeholder approach. Paano po magkaroon ng trust building and confidence building, and syempre at the root of it, the use of firearms, paano po iwasan sa violence, and that requires peace education formalized with the religious intricacy and stakeholders in partnership with the defense.
Samira Gutok, and then our next panelist, Ms. Amina Rasul, will ask her questions. Go ahead, ma'am.
Thank you. Salam, greetings of peace to everyone. First, magtatanong ako tungkol sa position nyo sa mga kababaihan natin. In Mindanao and elsewhere, violent extremism and extremist thought, misogyny, are threatening not just our peace, but our gains on women's rights. The UN Security Council adopted a resolution, Resolution 1325, on women, peace, and security in the year 2000. The Philippines is the first country in Asia to implement a national action plan on women, peace, and security, reaffirming the important role of women in all aspects of peace building, post-conflict reconstruction, stressing the importance of women's equal participation and full involvement in all efforts for the maintenance and promotion of peace and security. Ngayon, yung UN Security Council Resolution 1325 urges all states, all actors to increase the participation of women in decision-making to protect women from gender-based violence, but over the last couple of years, na-notice na namin na nag-decline ang participation of women, in part because of the pandemic. How will your administration promote and support the participation of women? How will you better implement itong National Action Plan on Women, Peace, and Security?
Okay, ang una po yung sasagot sa tanong na yon is Senator Coco Pimentel. Go ahead, sir.
Ako pala. Okay, hello first to Amina. In addition to what the provisions in the organic law, kasi nandun nga sa organic law, the reserved seat for the women, sa party list system, I encourage women's groups or those advocating women's rights to organize so that they can participate in this proportional representation system. The president can appoint, diba, or should appoint Bangsamoro representatives in all agencies with projects or concerns in the Bangsamoro, in the intergovernmental relations bodies. So, since this is presidential discretion, the Senator Manny Pacquiao for sure will equalize or increase women's representation in his political decisions, especially the appointees. Ganun po yun, kasi member din kami ng IPU. Ang sa IPU, very conscious doon, binibilang po nila yung representation sa parliament ng male. So we will pursue that principle in our appointments.
Okay, salamat po, Senator Coco. Next is Secretary Manny Piñol.
I will recommend to my principal, Senator Ping Lacson. Hi, Amina. Yung pagpapalakas ng mga livelihood projects ng ating kababaihan, kasi doon sila malakas eh. Yun yung kanilang forte. Like say, for example, sa Tawi-Tawi, tinutulungan na natin yung mga seaweed farmers dyan na magtanim. Meron na tayong solar system to dry the seaweeds. We could go a rung higher sa development because right now we need a lot of natural fertilizers. Isang programa na ipopropose ko sa aking presidente, turuan natin yung kababaihan sa islands, lalong-lalo na sa Sulu, Tawi-Tawi, Basilan, na mag-process ng kanilang seaweeds into natural fertilizer. This is a gold mine actually. Sapagkat napakataas ang presyo ng abono ngayon, kailangan natin ng mga natural fertilizers, and the women in the Bangsamoro area could actually focus on this livelihood project. Malaking maitutulong sa kanilang pamilya. Tingin ko ang talagang malakas na area ng mga kababayan sa Bangsamoro would be the livelihood activities.
Secretary Piñol, next, Congressman Teddy Bagilat.
Hello, hi, Mama Mina. Ako, I really agree that the peace builders are women. Kasi gano'n rin sa amin, sa mga katutubong pamayanan. May mga tribal wars, yung mga hidmuan, yung mga babae talaga ang mga mediators. No? We have a lot of laws, Magna Carta for Women, anti-violence against women and children. So let's just make sure that it is properly implemented sa Bangsamoro region. Pero kay Ma'am Leni, I agree, no? Political empowerment rin kasi depends on economic empowerment. Kaya ngayong kanyang angat buhay program, which is livelihood, naka-focus talaga sa women because if you empower them economically, meron silang kita, tumataas yung kanilang self-esteem, tumataas yung pagtingin ng komunidad at ng pamilya sa kanila, at mas lalo nilang naipaglalaban yung kanilang mga karapatan. And Leni Obredo herself is an embodiment of political empowerment of women. Maraming salamat po.
Okay, salamat po. Next, Ms. Samira Gutok.
Sir, sensitize, ma'am. Amina, hello, ma'am. Sensitize the men about 1325 kasi po sila po yung nasa, sadly, syempre, nasa hierarchy sila eh. Sila po yung nasa taas eh. So how can 1325 be an operational part of any agency? Every minister having not just a woman by token appointment, but really a 1325 implementer in his line agency. And if commission and audit, a national agency, can help in promoting such SDG indexing, HDI indexing, GAD gender development indexing, and 1325 indexing kasi lahat naman ay issues of women, di ba? So we have to intricately interconnect everything and not be a victim mentality. So yung ulamas, there's a mufti, advisor of the BARM, if pwede po meron siya ring maybe advisory on this level of
how women can be participants in the BARM governance, BARM level of peace, so that we are actively, not just token appointed.
Okay. Salamat, Ms. Amira Gutok. Finally, Mr. Sonny Melencio.
Salamat sa tanong, Ms. Armina, ma'am. Si Caliote ay nagpanggit na na dadamihan niya o 50% ng kanyang cabinet ay manggagaling sa kababaihan at saka sa LGBTQI+. Pinag-uusapan namin at nag-start na kaming mamili para matiyak na nasa position of power yung ating mga women leaders. Now, we also need an enabling environment para doon sa inclusive participation at kababaihan. Kasi kung kailangan mapalaya natin sila sa multiple burden doon sa home, sa bahay, kaya kailangan talagang mag-start na tayo ma-develop yung kanilang career, yung kanilang trabaho. And I'm thinking of also of the MSME. Ang MSME, yung medium scale, micro, medium scale entrepreneurship natin, ay 90% ay kababaihan ang nagpapatakbo noon. We need to empower them more, like put up a women's bank para matulungan sila, priority sila para sa pag-develop ng kanilang mga negosyo.
Okay, maraming salamat po. Again, ito na sa last part na po tayo, no? We will ask Ms. Amina Rasul to ask a follow-up question, pero doon po sa response ng mga guests po natin, you will be given 30 seconds each. And then after Ms. Rasul asks her question at sumagot po yung mga guests natin, meron pong isang follow-up question si Professor Pancho Lara. In the meantime, go ahead, ma'am, for your second question.
For beauty daw eh, kaya have a second question. Tsaka the woman gets the last word daw eh. Pasok tayo sa teritoryo at yaman. The Philippines claims territories in the Spratlys and in Sabah, Malaysia. Of the two claims, Sabah has the most resources to be gained, particularly beneficial to BARM and Mindanao. Ngayon, alam na natin yung claim natin sa Sabah derives from the Sultanate of Sulu, dahil the Sultan of Sulu came to the aid of the Sultan of Brunei in a civil war in the 1600s, and the Sultan of Brunei gave Sabah to the Sultan of Sulu. We filed a claim sa International Court of Justice. Wala pa nangyayari. The Philippines has filed a case before France, itong mga descendants ng Sultan, and the French Arbitration Court instructed the Malaysian government to pay $14.9 billion to the descendants of Sulu Sultan. Pero Malaysian Foreign Minister Saifuddin Abdullah says that this final award on the claim of the heirs does not affect the position of Sabah as a state in the Federation of Malaysia. How will your administration address the Sabah claim and get back our territory, sovereign and proprietary claim?
Okay, maraming salamat po. Napaka-complicated ng question at saka ng issue, pero pasensya na kayo. 30 seconds each, okay? Isang maliwanag na position regarding the Sabah question. The first to respond is Mr. Sonny Melencio. Kindly unmute yourself, sir.
Sorry. Yes, it's a very complicated issue kasi may mga kaibigan ako sa Malaysia, mga organisasyon din, and they're filling me in kung ano yung naman kanilang side doon. Kaya ibig sabihin, we have to strengthen our claim doon sa Sabah. And I remember also, binanggit ng aming senador si Luke Espiritu, it's not just a property claim. Yung pinakadulo niyan, it's the right to self-determination of the Sabah people. So we have to consult them kung paano. Kailangan may process na consultation na gawin.
Okay, pasensya na po. Alam ko na beating kayo ron. Pero maraming salamat po, Mr. Sonny Melencio. Next, si Senator Coco Pimentel.
Okay, whenever we pursue a claim, like the Sabah claim, we will do it peacefully and in accordance with international law. Yan lang po, yun po ang ating mga guiding principles dyan.
pero ipo-pursue nyo? Will you revive the Saba claim? Kasi dormant po siya ngayon eh.
Yes, it has been assigned to the Philippine government in the 1960s. So it's the responsibility of the Philippine government to safeguard what has been assigned to it by the Sultanate of Sulu.
Okay. Secretary Manny Piñol.
Mabuti na lang, Christian, na itanong ko to kay Ping Lacson bago itong forum na ito. Kasi ito si isa sa mga issues na ni-raise ko sa kanila. Let's come up with a definitive stance on the Sabah issue. And the position of my party is Sabah is part of the territory of the Philippines. Atin ang Sabah. We should not allow our claim to it to be dormant. But of course, let us pursue this in a peaceful and friendly diplomatic way. Thank you.
Congressman Teddy Bagilat.
Yeah, well, Vice President Lenny Robredo is really committed to uphold our constitution, which includes, of course, our legitimate historical claims to the West Philippine Sea at saka sa Sabah. And we will be working with the Sultanate of Sulu in order to pursue this claim. Siyempre, this will be done through mediation and negotiation with the Malaysian government. Perhaps ang entry point is also looking into the welfare of the Filipinos in Sabah. Kasi stateless sila eh. Sila natutulungan ng Philippine government at the same time the Malaysian government. So baka yun yung unang entry point in negotiating with the Malaysian.
Okay, salamat po sa sagot. And then finally, si Ms. Samira Gutok.
Of course, not just the DFA advisory, Malaysia and Philippines talking. Alam natin Malaysia was mediating the Bangsamoro talks. So yes, complicated po yan. Alam ko po yan. But let me look at it humanitarian-wise. As an evacuation leader on the halaus of Sabah, I would want that they be taken care of, our Filipinos in Sabah be put into a program wherein their ayuda and all their needs as a Filipino, a Philippine government are also looked into because that is what Bilis Kilos stands for, assistance to the vulnerables.
So yung pagsasalita niyo because of the time limit, pero maraming salamat po. Ang ating final question will come from Professor Pancho Lara. Again, you will have 30 seconds each to respond to this question. Go ahead, sir.
Yeah, this is a question that can be answered with a simple yes or no. I was following up the discussion earlier. This is a new question that came to my mind, no? Listening to Secretary Piñol, Governor Bagilat, no? Especially, no? And you were discussing a while ago the Black Grant and the Special Development Fund, and you said that whether or not it's increased, no, or lowered, you know, the important thing was that you wanted to see that those funds were effectively and efficiently used, especially since the Bangsamoro government, the BPA, has been in existence now for 3 years. So my question is, would you support an external audit of the funds starting from 2019 up to 2022 prior to the start of the next 3-year term of the Bangsamoro? Yes or no?
Mabigat po yung tanong na yan. Ang una pong sasagot, si Ms. Samira Gutok.
In the Bilis Kilos philosophy, we always welcome a assessment and an open data that is available to the public. So, Sir Pancho, hindi naman siya hostile, no, to ask that how is the funds, because Congress always asks naman as oversight, no. And of course, we'd also like to affirm, as input to ISCO would say that, of course, the war has taken so much of us, martial law period, no, 1970. So why look into a decrease of a block grants, lalo pang tingnan yung affirmation, push, and even leveraging increase when most of the money salaries.
Salamat po. Next, Mr. Sonny Milencio.
Yes, I think we should discuss it with them that we need an audit, and they would understand na yung mga bagay na yun, because it's a grant of fund, would have to be audited para makita nung lahat. Kasi if it needs to be raised, then so much the better. Kailangan natin ng auditing para mapalaki pa yung grant. Thanks.
Salamat po, Mr. Sonny Milencio. Next, Senator Coco Pimentel.
I remember the debates about this during the consideration of the BOL. Ang conclusion namin doon, it's COA. COA should audit BARM funds. Wala pong lusot yan. It's just like any other government agency. The BARM expenditure should be audited by COA.
Sir Coco Pimentel, and then Secretary Manny Piñol.
Yes, of course. All government funds should be audited and be subjected to scrutiny. Kasi yun din ang magiging basis natin eh. Kung dadagdagan ba natin, kung effective ba yung utilization, dadagdagan natin kung kulang. At kung hindi naman tama yung paggamit, then we could correct it. Yes, it should be audited.
Thank you. And then finally, Congressman Teddy Bagilat.
Yeah, Lenny Robredo has always been a champion of good governance, transparency, and accountability. Kaya nga, sinusuportahan niya yung People's Empowerment Law, sinusuportahan namin yung freedom of information, sinusuportahan niya yung pagpapalakas ng mandato ng Commission on Audit. So therefore, in answer to the question of Sir Pancho, yes. Yes na yes.
Okay, maraming salamat po for those very clear answers. And that ends part 2 of our forum for today. We would like to thank our panelists and of course our guests. At ngayon po, we will hear from Ms. Nikki Feline de la Rosa. Siya po ang Country Director ng International Alert Philippines for her closing remarks.
Maraming salamat, Christian. Narinig na po natin ngayong umaga mula sa mga kinatawan ng ating mga presidentials ang mga plataforma de gobyerno ng kanilang isusulong bilang tugon sa mahalagang issue at urgent na mga suliranin sa BARM na hinarap ng ating moderator, ng panel of experts at mga representante ng iba't ibang sektor. Pinag-usapan natin ngayong umaga ang mahalagang issue ng mamamayan na nasasakupan ng BARM, no? Hinggil sa political transition ng rehiyon at ang relasyon ng national government at regional government within the autonomy provision ng Bangsamoro Organic Law, but also within the furtherance of the objective of national development, lalo na sa usapin ng edukasyon, ng public health, economic development at karapatan ng mga minoridad. Napag-usapan din natin yung issue ng lupa, particular na dito ang pagsulong ng karapatan at kapakanan ng mga non-Moro indigenous peoples na naninirahan sa BARM, lalo na tungkol sa kanilang ancestral domain. Proteksyon at pagsulong din ng karapatan at kapakanan ng mga kababaihan, ng mga kabataan at mga LGBTQI. At panghuli, ang masalimuot na usapin ng normalization at decommissioning at ng transitional justice at ang mas komprehensibo at sustainable na pag-address ng issue ng violent extremism. Kasama na po dito ang usapin ng Marawi at ang pagtiyak sa bayad, pinsala at pagbalik ng mga Maranao IDP sa kanilang mga tirahan. We drill down on the issue of the extension of the political transition and the necessity of an inclusive process. Sa issue po ng illicit weapons at implikasyon nito sa decommissioning ng former combatants, pati na rin doon sa neutralization ng private armed groups at ang usapin ng human development sa rehiyon, particularly ng mga marginalized at vulnerable groups, no, sa BARM. Tatlong bagay ang naging tampok sa diskusyon natin ngayong umaga. Una, malinaw na marami at mabigat ang mga suliranin ng mga mamamayan ng BARM at ang seryosong implikasyon ng mga ito kapag hindi kagiyat na tinugunan ng mga liderato ng BARM at ng national government. Pangunahin dito ang pagkilala sa proteksyon at pagsulong ng mga karapatan ng mga mamamayan ito. Ang BARM ay bunga ng mahabang panahon ng negosasyon na nag-culminate sa isang landmark agreement ng MILF in 2014. Pero crucial sa ongoing transition process sa BARM na maramdaman ng mga mamamayan nito ang bunga ng peace process na kanilang sinuportahan na sana ay magresulta sa pag-improve ng kanilang buhay sa araw-araw at ang kanilang karapatan ay pantay anuman ang kanilang kinabibilangan. Pangalawa, hindi maaring business as usual at status quo lamang ang papel na gagampanan ng national government sa pamamahala ng BARM. Malinaw ang datos at ebidensya na binanggit sa forum na ito na ang BARM governance ay nangangailangan ng bukas at sama-samang pagtingin at aksyon mula sa nasasakupan nito, mula sa transition authority at ng national government. Pangatlo at panghuli, ang forum ay tumulong sa pagklaro kung ano ang magiging priority ng mga potensyal na pangulo ng bansa pagdating sa usapin ng BARM, lalo na ang pagtugon sa mga suliraning nabanggit. Totoong mahaba pa ang landasin at marami pa ang kailangan gawin ng bawat isa sa atin upang makamit ang ganap na biyaya ng kapayapaan sa Bangsamoro. We hope that the forum today contributed to our collective understanding of the key issues in the ongoing political and economic transition of the region and what is required to untangle the complex problems and reach a solution that will stick and is responsive to the needs and aspirations of the different constituents of the region. Sa ngalan po ng International Alert at ng Institute for Autonomy and Governance at ang ating mga panel of experts na si Professor Francisco Lara Jr., kay Attorney Benny Bacani, kay Ms. Amina Rasul at ang ating moderator ng si Christian Esguera at sa kanyang production team. Taos-puso po kami nagpapasalamat sa ating mga guests ngayong umaga kay Representative Teddy Bagilat, Ms. Samira Guto, Mr. Sonny Melencio, Secretary Manny Piñol at Senator Coco Pimentel. At sa inyong lahat na nagbigay ng oras sa umagang ito para dumalo sa aming forum, maraming salamat po at mabuhay kayo. Magandang tanghali po at magandang hapon po muli. Thank you, Christian.
Maraming salamat for that message, Ms. Nikki De La Rosa. Pero bago po tayo magpaalam, we'd like to invite everyone to please turn on their Zoom cameras for our group photo. Okay. Yan, isa pa raw. 1, 2, 3. Isa pa raw po. Okay. 1, 2, 3. Okay na raw. Okay. At dito po nagtatapos ang ating forum, the Bangsamoro Agenda 2022. Naway mas naging malinaw ang iba't ibang issue tungkol po sa Bangsamoro, lalo na ang plano para dito ng mga nagnanais na maging susunod na pangulo ng ating pong bansa. Maraming salamat muli sa Institute for Autonomy and Governance at International Alert Philippines at sa ating media partners, yan po ang Press1.ph, ang Facts First Podcast, ang ABS-CBN News Channel at Rappler po. Sa ating live stream partners, DXMS Radyo Bida Cotabato, the Journalism Studies Association of the Philippines, the Philippine Press Institute, and the Private Education Assistance Committee. Maraming salamat po sa inyo. At muli, ako po si Christian Esguera. And thank you for joining us for this forum.